looking inside PNC Arena, where tonight the 5-0 Carolina Hurricanes welcome in the Boston Bruins. And then there were just three undefeated teams left this NHL season, as the Hurricanes are joined by the Florida Panthers and St. Louis Blues. And the Canes would love to stay in this elite club this season. Hello, everyone. Alongside Tripp Tracy, I'm Mike Maniscalco. And, well, Tripp, a big reason, literally and figuratively, why the Hurricanes are 5-0 this season has been the goaltending of Frederik Andersen. What has he meant so far to this Canes, his new team this year?
Everything. I mean, when I look at so far the finest goaltending performances in the league, you think of Jordan Binnington with St. Louis, Bobrovsky in Florida, Sorokin, a couple of shutouts for the Islanders. But I think Freddie Andersen has been the best goaltender so far in the NHL. And I say that for a couple of different reasons. A new team, the all-important statistic of winning. He's played every game, so he's been a workhorse. And then you get to the sparkling individual goaltending statistics. Look at that save percentage. So when I factor in all of that, and you hope it will continue, Freddie Andersen has been the hottest goalie in hockey so far.
Well, three things to know about the 5-0. Freddie Andersen, one of three goaltenders left in the league with that record. First in franchise history to win five decisions, and second in NHL history to win his team's first five decisions when coming to a new team. Well, Tripp, as you know, a goaltender's best friend is the defense. And Jacob Slavin, he got his penalty for the year out of the way. But again, solid. You talk about the consistency. What has he brought so far in this early season to the Canes yet again?
What he seems to bring every year, and that is elite, elite, elite. What he does defensively, and does it with such a good stick, and the rarity of taking a penalty. That's why he's the reigning Lady Bing Award winner. He has five assists. I mean, I still think that he is tapping into more of an impact on the offensive side of the puck. And he showed that coming out of the box against Toronto, this incredible one-on-one move, and then Niederreiter finishing it. That was highlight reel.
Earlier, Tripp caught up with Jacob Slavin.
Jacob is a leader on this team. I'll tell you what, you guys never cheat us with regards to your compete, your desperation. Why do you think that is?
That's one of the things Roddy instills in us, and one of the things that identifies us as a team, as an organization, is our effort level. And so every given night, we want to make sure we're giving ourselves a chance to win, and the only way we can do that is if we can compete.
You haven't seen the Boston Bruins in a minute, but you're still very familiar. What are the unique individual skill sets of Brad Marchand, Patrice Bergeron, and David Pastrnak?
I mean, individually, they're all really, really solid players, all high-end, high-skill, super smart. And then you put the three of them together, and they can make some special things happen. So we just got to make sure we're taking away their time and space tonight, make sure we're up in their face and not giving them those opportunities to make the skill plays that they're capable of.
Good stuff, and good luck, my friend.
Thank you.
Well, tonight's opponent, the Boston Bruins, might have the most complete line in the NHL in that top line of Bergeron with Pastrnak. But the straw that stirs the drink on that line is Brad Marchand, Tripp.
Well, listen, rigorous honesty. The conference final 3 years ago, he ticked me off because of the way that he mocked the great Justin Williams. But he is flat out possibly the best left winger in the National Hockey League because he plays and flourishes in all situations. He's a true pro. He is an everydayer. And he had, and his line had sort of a silent night last night. I expect them to be good tonight.
Well, they are the big bears of the Bruins. Marchand, Bergeron, and Pastrnak. The numbers speak for themselves as far as points, but it's that trio that is so dangerous and keeps the Bruins so good year after year. But the Canes are trying to climb that mountain, and they've got to knock off the Bruins in a measuring stick game coming up here on Bally Sports Cell. Game two of a four-game homestand when they take on the Bruins, and Frederik Andersen making his sixth consecutive start to start this season for the Hurricanes. He has been dazzling in that Carolina Hurricanes red uniform. For the Boston Bruins, it's Jeremy Swayman. He's 1-1 on the season with a 3.02 goals against average. But the Bruins are trying to come back after a tough loss last night against Florida, where they were beaten 4-1. And the top two lines that you can look at it, at least for Boston, Patrice Bergeron will dig in against Jordan Staal. And here we go. We've got hockey in Raleigh. A huge hit right off the top of the show as Ethan Bear levels Marchand, but Boston gets the puck into the Canes zone. Carolina survives and will throw it in to Nino Niederreiter. There's a chance materialized, but Bear laying the lumber early in this one, and there's going to be a stoppage of play, Tripp.
Well, that tells you that Ethan Bear is familiar with what this game is going to mean to his new teammates.
Beautiful hit through the body. You want to finish Brad Marchand. Any chance you get, you already feel the care across the board. And Ethan Bear knows, like his partner Jacob Slavin, this is a meaningful game. That's a heck of a clean hit in the neutral zone.
Bergeron and Staal will do it again, this time to the left of Anderson, and we'll have to do this again as there was a jump start there in the circle. So time off the clock, and we'll drop the puck again. Carolina Hurricanes coming in at 5-0. The second time under Rod Brind'Amour at 5-0. Draw was one. McAvoy shot. Rockets past the Kings net. Work down low. Bergeron has a chance. Steps out in front. His backhand is deflected away. Niederreiter might have gotten a stick to that. Now Marchand gives away the puck. Kings get to it. Niederreiter will whistle this one in on Swayman as the Kings will make a change. Niederreiter will head to the bench. Boston will follow suit. And the Bergeron line goes off. Now for Carolina, it's Teravainen, Svechnikov, and Aho. The puck rolls in on Anderson. We've got 55 seconds gone here in the first period. Now Svechnikov has a step, lowers the shoulder, shoots, goes high over the top of the net. As Swayman had to stare down Svechnikov, who has been on fire. Now a cross-ice pass. Connecting the dots are the Canes. Shot from the slot, can't get through by Pesci, and that'll flex out of the zone off of Eric Halla, his one-time teammate. The Canes will be offside, stopping play.
Well, a couple of good early chances. I think a fine defensive play from Jordan Staal with his reach. Even when you lose the positioning battle, you can make up with it with the stick, and that's captain on captain. And you mentioned that Svechnikov has a step. He's had a step all year long. McAvoy, heck of a play. He was our player to watch on the Boston side. I think he's got a piece of that. The puck went end over end over the net.
For Svechnikov on the season, he has got 9 points, 5 goals, 4 assists. He's tied for 7th in the league in scoring here in the early going. And he has been a man on a mission for the Carolina Hurricanes, but so is this whole club. Getting off to the 5-0 start, 2-0 at home. Boston on the season, 3-2, 1-2 away from the confines of TD Garden. Now Trocheck, chased down Drizlik. Boston can't clear, kept in by Slavin. Kotkaniemi and Trocheck will poke it further, but Boston will get to a loose puck. Taylor Hall can't handle it, and right back into the zone. It's Natchez. He pulls up trying to find Trocheck just a little too far. Kotkaniemi takes a shoulder from Stidnica, kept in for Bear. Bear shot, deflects, and that hits Trocheck as he was fell to the ice and a little bit of a pain getting up after taking that puck. The Canes will make a change right now as Boston will just send the puck in the Hurricanes in.
Nate just needs something good to happen. I would like to see him be selfish and shoot the puck there. We know what kind of release he has.
North Carolina sending the puck into the Bruins zone. As the Crazy Eights of Stefan Martinuk and Stevie Lawrence on the ice. Lawrence, his first game-winning goal of the season against Toronto the other night. Now it's Cole shouldering the puck to Lawrence. And the Canes will clear it up for Martinuk. Martinuk, one of those players who definitely feels the burn when the Boston Bruins come into town. And those two postseason exits, courtesy of Boston. Now Martinuk and company keeping it in. D'Angelo had it, tried to send it down low. Instead, he'll have to regroup. The Canes will do that, but this misses everybody, and that'll be an icing on the Carolina Hurricanes. 16:57 to go here in the first, and a chance to get a look at the defensive pairs for Rod Brind'Amour.
I focus on Brett Pesci because thankfully he's okay. I talked to him after the game about that Nick Ritchie hit. He didn't like it. He concurred that he thought it was dirty. Unfortunately, no ramifications after the fact. But far, far more important is that Pesci is good to go. Pesci did not play in the playoff series against Boston in the bubble. He was a big loss.
Absolutely. And for the Carolina Hurricanes, Brett Pesci and Jacob Slavin, the two stalwarts back there. Those Canes team, hard to believe that they're both in their 7th season, both at 27 years old. And here for a few more years as well for the Canes, anchoring the blue line. Now Brady Shea is given a hard hit by Pasternak into the corner, as you saw that up close and personal, and Boston can't keep it in.
That tells you Boston's playing with some urgency. They had a good first period in Florida, but lost as the Panthers went to 7-0.
Now Pasternak trying to dance in, but he loses the puck as Shea held his ground, giving no time and space there for the talented Bruins winger. Now Pesci cruises into the Boston zone. Pass a little too far for Niederreiter, and the Bruins back the other way. Marchand. Oh, excellent play by Teravainen to foil that chance, and the Bruins go make a change as McAvoy winds it into the Hurricanes end. Hala tries to deliver a hit in the corner, and he chopped it right on. Anderson has to make the save. Rebounding, Lazar throws one. Anderson with another save. Oh, Frederik Andersen called on early here tonight. He's made two big saves.
Well, he has those quick feet. Of course, I call them pinball flippers. The first shot, I don't think he saw it. He was screened. So I think it was an underrated stop, and then he had to follow it up.
Now we'll get a whistle. I mean,
it's rare that you see a big man have quick feet like he does. And the way he angles pucks, DeBrusk does an excellent job of denying the board outlet the way Matthews did on Toronto's first goal the other night. Yeah, you can see his late reaction. He did not locate that until the end. And a good lower body save on both sides.
His name isn't Tommy, it's Freddie. And he has been, as Tripp likes to say, the pinball wizard in the crease, using those pads as flippers so far in this early season, as Boston has an early shot advantage in this one. Out shooting Carolina 4-0. Canes still looking for their first. Jesperi Kotkaniemi take the draw against Eric Halla. He spent the majority of the 19-20 season with the Carolina Hurricanes. Of course, he was dealt for Vincent Trocheck, that man right there who knocks the puck behind the Bruins' net. Now his stretch pass will be deflected into the Canes' zone off of the stick of Lazar, but too far, and that'll stop play, and we get a chance to look at the injuries and scratches.
Well, Rod continues with the same lineup. I do think that we will, in all likelihood, see Antti Raanta tomorrow, and I do think we will see Brendan Smith and Seth Jarvis, my gut tells me, either against Chicago or against the Arizona Coyotes, an afternoon start on Sunday. For Boston, of course, Tuukka Rask will not be back until later this season. No David Krejci has gone back to the Czech Elite League, and boy, what a Bruin he was for so many years.
Yes, you can say, as we'll have to face off again, you can say that he was overshadowed many times in that Bruins lineup, but they'll tell you how valuable Krejci was to that team.
It changes the look of your team, because we always talk about depth at center ice, the cerebral nature, the tremendous skill. He was a great Boston Bruin.
Jack Stadnicka now taking over that second spot at center for the Bruins. And it's Natchez sending it to Cole. Cole bounces one, and Swayman gets a glove to it, but can't control. Cole down low from his defensive position. Kotkaniemi throws one out in front. And that just misses the stick of Trocheck, and now a skate race where D'Angelo gets his stick to it. Knocking that puck away from Jake DeBrusk. Haynes is, again, showing good sticks in the defensive zone, interrupting passes against Boston here in this one. 14:45 left in the first period. Trocheck gets the puck to Natchez. Bouncing puck, Natchez delivers a heavy hit along the boards. Boston will clear, but right to the stick of Jacob Slavin. Kotkaniemi with room to work. Cross ice pass for Ethan Bear, who was charging in a little too far. The Canes will recover, is taking in place of Bear was Stepan, defensively responsible for the 31-year-old Derek Stepan, who signed this offseason with the Carolina Hurricanes.
You have to start your shift on time. Stepan took a look as soon as he hit the ice, recognized Barrett lost his footing and was caught. So he filled very nicely.
Lawrence gets it back to D'Angelo, cross for Cole. Cross ice, one-timer for Lawrence, and it jumps up on Lawrence before he could connect the good lumber to it. Oh, he'll work it back up. Cole thinks about it. His shot, that'll hit Martinuk before it can find Swayman. And the Bruins will break out. Throwing the puck into the Hurricanes in. And Stepan puts a shove there to Kuhlman. Bruins try to work a cycle, but the Canes will intercept. Lawrence was streaking to the middle of the ice, but the pass had a little bit too much mustard on that one. Boston will settle it down to Kuhlman. Flips it to the Canes' blue line. 13:25 to go here in the first period. No score. Bruins and Canes.
Bruins are built differently than they were a few years ago. They're nowhere near as physical.
Now Bergeron and D'Angelo fighting along the boards, and D'Angelo takes it away from the Selke Trophy winner. Feels like every year for Boston. Now Jesper Fast with a huge hit on Zboril, forcing a turnover for the moment. But the Bruins will get to the puck. Marchand can't handle it. The Canes have brought their physical game here early against the Boston Bruins. We're under 13 minutes to go here in the first period. Now Stahl gets to the puck in the corner. And Forbert, now Niederreiter, Zboril, and Bergeron. A couple more guys will get a quorum now out in front. A chance for Jesper Fasten. Swayman denies him. As the Canes, great work in the corner. Throw it out in front. Jesper Fasten almost had his fourth of the season.
What a pass.
The Carolina Hurricanes. What a pass from Nino Niederreiter. Canes almost went up one early in this one.
The arena is the place to be these days with this undefeated Hurricanes team to start the season. And before you say, well, maybe you're biased, Abby, how about we hear from another coach in the NHL? And our Geico quote of the day, it comes from head coach of the Maple Leafs, Sheldon Keefe. Playing on the road here in Carolina, it's a different animal. Guys, he went on to say that our team has not felt that in quite some time. It requires a lot more from you as a team, and it's really eye-opening. That goes to show, hey, there's a seventh man here for the Canes, guys.
Gabby, good stuff. That's a combination of course, the atmosphere and the fact that Carolina pressures and takes away time and space more than certainly any other team the Leafs had seen.
Without a doubt. Now Boston trying to get a chance, but again, the good sticks of the Carolina Hurricanes deflect that away. When this building is in full throat, it is one of the more intimidating places to play as Natchez is taken out of the play, and Boston emerges with a step. It's DeBrusk going in, and Anderson will get a pad to it. Frederick Anderson continues to hold the line for the Carolina Hurricanes in the early portion of this season.
Jake DeBrusk is flying so far tonight. He was able to come up with a puck on the wall that led to a chance. And here, I mean, Tony D'Angelo can skate. And he wins this race up the ice. And Freddie Anderson gets out, matches the speed, and he forces him to miss. Reminds me of a couple of saves, breakaway saves that Anderson made a week ago in Montreal, where you have to get out and match that speed because DeBrusk was really moving.
This game has had a pace that doesn't feel like game number six of the regular season for the Hurricanes and for the Bruins. A bit more on the line as we have got 12 minutes here to go in the first period. Shots on goal, 5 for Boston, 3 for the Hurricanes, and an ice against the Carolina Hurricanes. So icing and a draw coming back to the Canes.
Aho came close to beating that out. Just to, again, piggyback on Abby's point. I talked to Rod Brindamore about it on Tuesday. The atmosphere in here for a Monday night, yes, I know there was a ton of intrigue facing the Toronto Maple Leafs, was electric. And that included the wave from the Caniac Nation in the third period. I mean, I remember years ago, if it was a Monday game, I don't care if it was an intriguing opponent, which it was. It was nothing like that.
Well, there's been carryover tonight trip for the fans, and you can feel it. And it's a Thursday night here against the Boston Bruins. And there's just that jump here in the building right now. A lot to do with the start for the Carolina Hurricanes, where they're at. One of only three undefeated teams left in the NHL. After Edmonton was beaten by Philadelphia last night, as it'll be icing against Carolina. And back behind the play, David Pasternak, Sebastian Aho, and Marchand, as the top lines are getting a little wordy with each other.
Well, does time heal all wounds? No. Sebastian Aho, the fiery of all fiery competitors, he remembers the fact, I can guarantee you, that Pasternak, Marchand ended a season. Now, Pasternak loses his helmet here. He could have gotten a penalty, technically, because he then engaged in an altercation. He should have to go pick it up or go to the bench. Instead, he engages. I don't have a problem with it. Pasternak has been very physical so far tonight. He's produced, but he hasn't been himself so far this year. So it's not surprising to me that his energy has been there. But that was interesting because he loses that helmet. Technically, he should pivot, pick it up, or head to the bench.
Well, he made some repairs to his bucket. He's back out on the ice right now along with Patrice Bergeron. And now he'll have to take the draw. Bergeron waved out of center, and that'll allow Sebastian Aho to win. And that faceoff is pushed out of the Canes zone. Svechnikov handling it. A bouncing puck. He's settled down by the Hurricanes. Speaking of Pasternak, 5 points on the season trip. 2 goals and 3 assists, but he's the guy that you look at on the stat sheet at the end of the night almost on a regular basis, putting up multiple point games for this Bruins team. Again, just 3-2 on the early season for Boston as they'll be in offside, and that'll stop things. And I can let you know that tonight's featured item of the game is the Fanatics Ladies Hurricanes True Classic Home 3/4 sleeve tee. Secure yours at CarolinaProShop.com.
Sharp, if you're going to dress up as a huge Caniac for Halloween.
I'm interested in what you might be dressing up as.
I have something.
Oh.
I have something planned.
Cannot wait.
In the golf world.
I'm trying to think now. Now you piqued the interest, but the interest goes back to hockey here. The Hurricanes wrap the puck back into the Bruins zone. Throwing the puck to Jacob Slavin along the board. Slavin, he'll wrist one that finds its way to Swayman, and he'll have to glove that and hang on with 10:50 left to go here in the first period.
A matchup of two former coaches of the year in the National Hockey League, Jack Adams Award winners. When I said a few minutes ago that the Boston Bruins are not as physical as they were, say, when Carolina and Boston met in the Eastern Conference Final, I don't mean that in a negative way. They play the game correctly. Cassidy allows his best players to have their talents on display. He's done a heck of a job now for many years with the Original Six franchise.
Cassidy will be an assistant for Team Canada at the Winter Olympics in Beijing. So he has done a great job. And overall, we showed you his numbers with Boston. His numbers are very good as a head coach. His excellent play made by Lawrence to stop Nosek. He was trying to get a nose for the net. Ian Cole standing sturdy behind Canes, trying to clear. Martinuk tripped up at his own blue line, but the Canes will watch Boston send it back in their own end, and they'll regroup and reload. There have been opportunities to hit the opponent so far tonight, and both teams have taken advantage as Ian Cole slaps it behind the net. Trent Frederick tried to get a stick to it. Now Carolina watching the Bruins patrolling their zone, bouncing puck. Martinuk will find it. Can't clear it. Now Ian Cole has some time. Halfway through the first period. No score, no goals, depending on how you like to view that term, between the Hurricanes and Bruins. Charlie McAvoy, he had the 8-year contract extension. Striding into the Cane zone, tries a return feed. Frederick Anderson, astute with the stick, knocks it into the corner. And Kotkaniemi will clear to Natchez. Natchez tries to split two Bruins defenders, can't do it. Trocheck lost an edge going into the corner. Canes had what looked to be a promising chance develop into nothing.
Carolina's neutral zone can be better. McAvoy had a clean pass. You do not want to allow Boston with their team speed to rev up between the two blue lines.
Kotkaniemi gives chase in the corner. Trocheck with a smart stick. Knocks it back to Kotkaniemi. Kotkaniemi loses control. Bruins will clear, bouncing it off of the end boards and giving chase to the Boston Bruins with Pasternak just out of his reach. And he'll be pawed down by the 2014 first-round pick of the Bruins. And the puck finds its way to Marchand. He's harassed by Staal. Now Pesce finished along the boards, but the Bruins keep it in, bouncing it off the back of the Canes net. Carolina will clear. 8:40 to go here in the first period. Jesper Fast trying to get a stick, but he's beaten to the puck by four, but now he'll get it right back. Niederreiter trying to get it to Fast, still loose. Niederreiter shoots. It's blocked out in front by McAvoy, who makes the save. Kane still on the puck. Niederreiter to Staal. Bouncing puck. Staal tries to settle it. Takes a shoulder from Pasternak. Staal sends it out, but the puck hits Marchand's skate, and the Bruins will survive that.
Stanika, the centerman who was replacing David Krejci, saved a goal in desperation with his stick.
Canes hearing it from their fans for that attempt. Now Studnicka tries to create a scoring chance to Charlie Coyle out in front. Taylor Hall's shot bounces off the backboard. Still loose. The Canes will get a stick to it as Brady Shea keeps it away from Charlie Coyle. Now Teräväinen, his attempt to clear. He's tracked down by Studnicka. Now Coyle sent back up top. The shot is ripped by Grizzlick right into Anderson, and he'll hang on.
I think Anderson got a toe on it, Mike. Take a look at this. This was some kind of save.
Well, the Carolina Hurricanes have counted on Frederick Anderson a lot this season, and he has come up with a toe save when you need it. It's nothing-nothing here in the first period. .743 to go here in the first period, and for the Carolina Hurricanes, there have been some great individual performances this season, Trip, but it's been the collective that's gotten them to this 5-0 record.
The thing I think about right now is there, for many years in October, is you'd have max one day a week off.
and Rod Brind'Amour prioritizes rest. The greatest example of that was before they played the Bruins in the conference final a couple years ago. Between games 6 and 7, when they won here against Washington Monday, they didn't practice Tuesday. They didn't have a morning skate Wednesday. Rod prioritizes recovery, which is a big deal to me.
Talks about that with Bill Burniston, the head strength and conditioning coach, about using rest as a weapon. As the Canes, Trocheck throws one and Swayman has to make the save. Kept in at the point by Cole. Now Carolina tries to keep it in, but Boston has come away. This wrist one in the Canes end. Will be collected by DeBrusk. His backhand intercepted by the Canes, and Carolina looking for some offense. Kotkaniemi gets a stick to it, but Grizzly gobbles up the loose change. Takes a slash from Natchez. We're throwing up the boards a little too far for Eric Haller. Now it's Brady Shea controlling for Carolina. 7 minutes to go here in the first period. Still looking for the first goal on this one. Now Martinuk firing into the Bruins zone. Can't get to the puck though. It's knocked to Forbert. Through the middle of the ice go the Bruins. Not so far though as Pesci is there. He calmed things down for the Canes. Chance to wrap it around again. Back in the Canes end. Pesci. Watches the puck find its way to Coleman, and now Stepan takes a shoulder, tries to get it to Martinuk, but McAvoy keeps in.
Heck of a play from Stepan there as the low centerman, denying a grade A chance.
And the Canes will go for a change as they deflect the puck into the Boston zone. And that line of Stepan, Lawrence, and Martinuk have provided a lot of energy for the Canes so far this season. Now it's Pasternak into the Canes zone to Marchand. Bear finishes Marchand. Boss tying up Bergeron. Pasternak seems to be everywhere on the ice, but so does Jacob Slavin. And Slavin takes him out of the play. Now up to Stahl. Little hand-eye coordination and shot right on, and Swayman will handle that. 5:59 to go here in the first period. The captain tried to get the first one of this game for the Canes. We're still scoreless. Martinuk, and they say that the playoffs will breed rivalries, and the Carolina Hurricanes certainly know that, and Jordan Martinuk told us about what it means when the Canes line up against the Bruins.
Obviously the history we have with them beating us in playoffs back-to-back years, and didn't get the chance to meet them last year, but if we would have, it would have been another big one. But yeah, this is the first game since that loss in the bubble, so it's definitely going to mean something for the guys that have been here.
It has been a long time since these two teams have gotten to reacquaint themselves. And again, Tripp, you don't want to make too much out of a game early in the season, but it does feel like a measuring stick game for the Canes as the draw is won by Carolina. Slavin's wrist shot deflects. Swayman will poke it to a open wing. Now Taylor Hall to Stugnika. It's off the draw. Bear set up Jacob Slavin. And now it's Sebastian Aho with some speed. Almost a big collision inside the blue line of Boston. Between Stugnik and Svechnikov. Aho trying to keep it in with some help from Teravainen, and it's going to be whistled offside against the Canes, stopping play right there.
Well, there has been some physicality both ways. Right off of the opening draw, the big hit from Ethan Bear on Brad Marchand. And it's continued. And when I look at this, to piggyback on what Jordan Martinuk was talking about, it's definitely a rivalry for the core group of the Carolina Hurricanes. I don't think Boston's playing with urgency because they lost last night. It will become a rivalry for Boston if Carolina can beat Boston and eliminate them. Much the same way I think the Carolina Hurricanes are a rival for Nashville and they're a rival for the Washington Capitals because they ended both of their seasons. And you hope that that progression will happen. It's been a well-played first period.
Well, that familiarity, as you know, breeds a lot of contempt, especially when you're on the wrong side of the scoreboard. For the Canes, they want to get on the right side here as we're still looking for the first goal. 5 minutes, 15 seconds in the first period. Is a shot by Kotkaniemi from far out is tracked by Swayman, and he'll hang on.
He's been good, Swayman, so far, the former standout at the University of Maine. He won the Mike Richter Award as the top goaltender in college hockey. And you're just hoping, if you're a Boston fan, that you can buy time until the great Tuukka Rask comes back.
The Anchorage, Alaska native did allow 5 goals on 24 shots his last time out against Philadelphia on the 20th of October. But again, he is tracking to be a good one. Very good in college at Maine. As Anderson will deflect the puck from outside the zone in the corner. A big tangle in the corner. And the come of it is D'Angelo uses the puck, Kotkaniemi gets it to Trocheck. Coming in, it's Natchez just out of his reach as Natchez had a lane. Carolina keeps it in. D'Angelo, he tees one up, they score! Carolina on the board first. It's 1-0 Hurricanes.
It may be the first goal for a defenseman if it went clean off of D'Angelo. Kotkaniemi, who had made a heck of a pass in the neutral zone, created the entry. Puck retrieval from Trocheck. Kotkaniemi goes to the front of the net. It hits Carlo, and then I think goes in the net. First glance, it looks like it is D'Angelo's goal. Kotkaniemi pointed at D'Angelo, but I'll tell you what. Kotkaniemi made the east-west pass in the neutral zone, and Tony D'Angelo may have his first as a Hurricane.
Well, either way for D'Angelo, it will be his first even strength point of the season as the puck deflects out of play. All four of his assists had come on the power play. He was tied for the lead in power play assists, and now his fifth point either way has put the Canes up 1-0.
Of course, I'm pulling for D'Angelo because the prediction segment, I have a defenseman scoring, but Kotkaniemi made the play in the neutral zone, and then he went to the front of the net. Heck of a shift from Jesperi Kotkaniemi. And D'Angelo wastes no time. Whether he risks it or he one-times it, he wastes no time and even strength on the power play getting pucks to the net.
The line of Trocheck, Natchez, and Kotkaniemi had had opportunities. They have generated a big chance here. Now back with the puck, it's D'Angelo to Cole. Cole bumpers it to Martinuk. He goes behind the net. The goal right now is credited to Tony D'Angelo as the Canes keep the pressure on. Swayman has to kick it into the corner. It's picked up by Lawrence, back to Cole. His shot pinballs behind the net. Lawrence cycling, spins, his shot goes wide. D'Angelo with the key. Get it down low, back to Lawrence, across for Cole. Cole's shot deflected, finds its way to D'Angelo. He puts one through the top of the blue paint as Martinuk was cruising for a deflection at the top. Now back to D'Angelo. Wrist one in. Swayman has to kick the pad out on that. As the Canes were going to go for a change. Instead, D'Angelo goes all the way back, and congratulations to Tony D'Angelo, his first goal as a member of the Carolina Hurricanes. Has him up 1-0 here against the Bruins late in the first.
Stepan going to the front of the net, just like Kotkaniemi did.
Now Stahl, he's got a lane. Throws it out in front, deflected away from Niederreiter. The Canes have put the pressure on since the goal from D'Angelo. Fast turns it away from Grizzlick. Now Stahl. The Niederreiter into the slot. Pesci's backhand goes over the top of the net as Brett Pesci had cruised in from his defensive position. Fast seals off Carlo along the wall. Jasper Fast has had a great start to the season. That's 1-on-2, and Fast waiting for some replacements. With a shot from Shea goes just wide, and that allowed the Canes to make some changes as well. Now Fast says that his shift is over, and the Canes fans roar with approval. Pasternak tries a cross-ice pass. Bear has trouble handling it. He is hit by Studnicka. Now Taylor Hall, he's taken down by Bear, now pinned along the boards. Good work by Ethan Bear. Aho has to avoid Pasternak. Bruins try to keep it in, and they will. It's Taylor Hall. Let's it go around the boards for Pasternak. Now Bear, chop at it. Kept in. Low shot in on Anderson as he makes the save as Forsberg put one in from the point. Svechnikov recovers and finds Aho just too far for the Canes centerman. He avoids a huge check behind the net. Now sets it out in front for Teravainen. And a rolling puck pops over Teravainen's stick. Taylor Hall might have had a good back check there to thwart that chance. Now along the boards to Nika. Pulls it away, sends it across, but Hall wasn't ready for it. Now Sporo keeps it in. Carolina looking to clear. Svechnikov, a blind pass out in front, turns it over to Coyle. Coyle now sends it across with room to move is Riley, but too much room from Riley. And the Canes are chasing the Bruins around in their own end right now. Now stepping out in front is Holla, the former Canadian. His shot is detected by Anderson, and that deflects out of play.
Let's go back to the goal and just watch Kotkaniemi. This is the pass I'm mentioning in the neutral zone. Rod gives his forwards the willingness and the ability to make plays. Puck retrieval from Vincent Trocheck. What a job he did. D-to-D pass, the two former Rangers. Does it Nick Kotkaniemi or not? I don't know. But forwards all under Rod Brind'Amour. They know they have the green light to make plays, but they have to manage the puck in important times too. And there, Kokaniemi makes a critical play in the neutral zone that eventually leads to the goal.
95 seconds to go here in the first period. Hurricanes up 1-0 on the Bruins. A goal right now that has been awarded to Tony DeAngelo, his first with the Hurricanes. Now the Canes looking for a little bit more as Kokaniemi, Trocheck, and Natchez applying the forecheck. McAvoy tries to find an escape route. He doesn't. The physical play continues, and the Canes keep the puck in the Boston zone just for a moment. Now Boston chips it forward. DeBrusk tracks it down in the Canes end. DeBrusk waits for reinforcements to come to the Canes zone. 60 seconds to go here in the first period. 1-0 lead for the Canes. Ian Paul, so calm with the puck, sends it, but it's going to go a little too far. Would have been icing, but it was right on for Swayman. So the Canes are able to make a change with 45 seconds left here in the first period. Bruins back in the Canes zone. Marchand's shot is detected by Anderson. Kicked it to the corner. Pesci gives Marchand a shove. Fost steps away from Bergeron. Great move there by Jesper Fost. Now off the boards, trying to find Niederreiter. Pass intercepted. Canes settle it down. Second chance for Niederreiter is the charm. Good reverse check there by Niederreiter on Brandon Carlo, but the puck comes free and Pasternak has it. Ian Marchand into the Canes zone. Shea steps in front of Pasternak. 15 seconds to go here in the first period.
Carolina's best line on the whole continues to be Fost, Niederreiter, and Jordan Staal. They have had some really quality shifts.
Now 7 seconds left in the period. Shea's clearing attempt doesn't go out. The puck will find its way out as Boston can't connect the dots. And the first period comes to an end. Well, stay tuned for the PNC Bank first intermission report. Nino Niederreiter will be Abby Labar's guest coming up. We will talk with Scott Burnside, the newest members of CarolinaHurricanes.com. Now the national hockey writers now here in Carolina will join our friends Abby and Shane. And we'll have first period highlights, and there were plenty of them. Frederick Anderson continues with the flipper saves. He had 11 saves in the first period. There were a ton of hits, but only one goal. It's Tony DeAngelo and the Hurricanes with a 1-0 lead after 20.
I am joined by Nino Niederreiter. 2 goals on the season for Nino. Not any in this game yet, but one for Tony DeAngelo. When you guys come out guns ablaze in the physicality between these two teams, how important is it for your team to get the first goal?
You couldn't tell. It's a lot of stake out there. I mean, we're fighting for inches, and always it was big that Tony got that goal and got us going a little bit. We were fighting our back a little bit, and I think we played better as the period went on.
I can feel it. You're still breathing heavy right here as we talk. But your line specifically has stayed together. You get better each and every game. How have you three continued to establish your dominance?
I think the biggest thing for us is just work as hard as we can and simplify the game as much as we can and outwork them down low, and I think that's been working for us.
That tough task of facing the Bruins top line, you're out there matched up with them. How have you felt about it early?
So far, so good. I mean, we got to find a way to get them frustrated, get them off their game. And so far, you can see it's Pasternak. He slammed his stick a couple times. That's exactly where we want him.
Thanks, Nino.
Thank you.
On the other side, we will catch up with Scott Burnside, the new addition to CarolinaHurricanes.com. Shane Willis and I will be with him next.
Genesis.
C-Bank, the official bank of the Carolina Hurricanes, and brought to you by UNC Rex Healthcare, official healthcare provider of the Hurricanes, and by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
It's a beautiful night in Raleigh, North Carolina, and it's even more beautiful when the Canes are up by 1 over the Boston Bruins as we welcome you into the PNC Bank intermission report, joined by all the fans here at the game, and Scott Burnside. Scott, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much. I was saying to Shane earlier, I covered the first playoff series after the team moved here in Greensboro, final in 02, 06, so feels like a second home away from home for me. So
there you go. Well, let's start with that. Scott is an award-winning journalist. He's been covering the NHL since 1997. You look great, though, for your age, let me just say.
It's very kind of you to say that, Abby.
And he now joins the Carolina Hurricanes as a special contributor. He will be on CarolinaHurricanes.com. He will be joining us a few times this season. So tell us more about your role with the Canes.
Well, we're going to do a little bit of everything. Actually, Shane's already had to put up with me along with Mike Maniscalco. We did the podcast the other day. Do a little bit of television and do some writing. As much as the Canes can put up with me, I'm happy to be producing. So.
Well, it's been a great start, obviously, starting with Mike and I on the podcast. But you mentioned 1997. You started covering the National Hockey League. First off, I want to know, what is it that you love the most about the game of hockey?
Well, I mean, I feel very fortunate. I was a news guy for a long time, and just covering a game that I grew up with, was never good enough to play it at a high level, but I feel very blessed to have had the opportunity to cover three Olympics, 15 or 16 or 17 Stanley Cup Finals, and really it's the people in the game that really, you know, it's what I think draws the fans. It's the action, of course, and the speed. But it's the personality of the players, too. And I think that's what's kept me going for a long time now.
All right, Scott, let's put that wealth of knowledge to work here right now. We're talking Hurricanes, their 5-0-0 start. What do you think has been the main contributor to that hot start for the Canes?
Well, I'll take the easy answer. And I think it's the seamless transition of Frederick Anderson as the starting netminder. And I think a lot of people wonder what the goaltending would look like, bringing in Antti Raanta, bringing in Frederick Anderson, two guys who have maybe had some durability issues in the past. I had a chance to talk to Frederick Anderson the other day, and he talked about his offseason going back to California, working out with a longtime trainer there, and really hitting the reset button after a very difficult year in Toronto. He was injured, couldn't play at the end of the season. I just think he's been a perfect fit here, and it's clear that Rod Brind'Amour and the coaching staff have decided to give Frederick Anderson lots of runway here. I was a bit surprised that he started the sixth straight game tonight, but boy, hard to argue with the results right now.
Well, I'm going to stick right there because you mentioned a guy in Rod Brind'Amour behind the bench and the way he's changed the culture here with this organization. You're around to lead the lock. You hear people talk about the Carolina Hurricanes. What is the biggest thing that jumps out to other people besides Rod and what he's done with this place?
Well, I do think it starts with Rod Brind'Amour, and I know that outside of this marketplace, he's considered one of the top young coaching talents in the game. And it really does start with him. You know, for me, and maybe it's because I've known Jordan Staal for a long time, but I think he sets a tone in terms of the captaincy, in terms of the way this team wants to play. There's all kinds of high-end talent. We know about that. Svechnikov, Aho, Nikash, the speed and the talent. But to me, Jordan Staal sort of like he's the conscience of this team. And that's what I like to watch. I thought he had a terrific first period. And to me, he's a guy, as we get closer to the playoffs, that's where his experience is critical. And I think he's a really important part of what this team has the ability to accomplish.
So you talked goaltending, the two acquisitions that the Canes had this offseason. They had other acquisitions as well. And as somebody who has covered the league from a national level, when you look at some of the new faces that the Canes brought in, who stands out to you?
Good. Now, you mentioned my age, Abby, but you know, for me, and I had a chance to catch up with Ian Cole a couple days ago. I hadn't seen Ian in a long time. Two Stanley Cups. He is an absolute warrior. He plays an old-school style of game. And I think, you know, no question, the team is going to miss Dougie Hamilton in the offense, all he brought. But I love what Ian Cole brings in terms of the makeup of this team. And again, this is a team, the regular season, of course, it's important. But this is a team that I think already has to be looking at, how do we stack up in the playoffs? Are we a team that's ready to take that next step? Ian Cole brings that experience, and he brings that gravitas to that dressing room. He is a very important piece of, I think, what is going to be a very interesting puzzle.
Awesome stuff. Thank you so much, Scott. We appreciate your input and knowledge. Tony DeAngelo scores his first goal of the season and as a Hurricane. We will have plenty more on the PNC Bank Intermission Report next.
When it comes to care,
is brought to you by Spectrum. Spectrum Mobile has unlimited talk, text, and data. Save up to 40%. Go to SpectrumMobile.com today.
$20.
20 minutes in the books at PNC Arena. The Hurricanes up 1-0 over the Boston Bruins, and here's how we got there. Hurricanes with great work from the Natchez, Trocheck, and Kotkaniemi line. Trocheck with a loose puck will get it to Brady Shea. It finds Tony DeAngelo. And right now, Tony DeAngelo with a great net front presence from Jesperi Kotkaniemi puts it past Jeremy Swayman, and this is the first goal of his Carolina Hurricanes career for Tony DeAngelo. When we come back, we'll see if he can get his second period right around the corner. Member of this Canes team, and the first by Hurricanes defenseman this season. Trip, that's good for you with your prediction from our pregame show in Hurricanes Live.
Kotkaniemi was close. I'm hoping it remains DeAngelo's, but yes, Barry getting to the front of the net after making the play on entry was very important.
Now the second period's underway. Fast. The puck in the corner. Step away. Niederreiter. This line has been so good for Rod Brindamore's team. His Barry's shot ricochets just wide. Now Slavin keeping it in. Finds a lane. Has it deflected away from him by Riley. Into the corner, though, Stahl. He'll exchange it right there with Fast. Fast tries to sneak one to a small opening, but it doesn't find the mark, and Bear will just slap it to center ice. Now it's Niederreiter. We'll take a heavy hit there from Mike Riley. Now we'll get some whistles, his pushes and shoves. Eric Holla, the former Kane, getting involved with it. Jesper Fast has a shove for him. Slavin comes into the picture. Brett Pesce comes down on Pasternak. Holla has some words. No love lost there between Holla and his former teammates.
Well, the best line for Carolina, there was a lot to like in the first period. Again, with Stahl, Niederreiter, and Fast playing against the big line for Boston. They had five shots between them. Nino didn't, I don't think, love the hit. And then Marchand comes in and sprays it. Whether it's intentional or not, Nino gave him a pretty good shot. And there's been a lot of animosity already in the early going, especially for the players. Yeah, so he sprayed him, and then he came over the top. So I think he called two aside here. They move on with 4-on-4 hockey.
First time tonight, we get to hear from our officials, Garrett Rank and Francois Saint-Laurent. Linesmen are Scott Cherry and Ryan Daisy tonight. And love to see the captain, Jordan Stahl, when that big body comes in and just seals off a player like Marchand, saying that's not going to happen, not tonight.
Rod would like to keep him on the ice for 4-on-4, but he just finished a shift. And so he's going to yank off the captain. If you think about this end of the rink, the epic goal in game 5, 4-on-4, that Jordan Stahl scored against the Nashville Predators. I'm sure he'll see some of this 4-on-4, so you start with the two fabulous Finns.
Well, the World Series going on, it's appropriate to be reminded of that goal as he batted out of air. Gave the Canes that big win, and yes, it is the two Finns as Sebastian Aho was taking the draw against Eric Holla. He's in the box, and yes, we have a cross check against Brad Marchand and a roughing against Nino Niederreiter in 4-on-4 hockey as Pesce works it across for Shea. Now Aho gets a stick to it, but DeBrusk accepts the pass and will flip it to the Canes zone. Pesce, tight turn to Shea. A bit more room to work for the Carolina Hurricanes Finns, Tara Vinen. Drop it off for Shea. His shot right on Swayman makes the save. Kicks it out to Pesce. Pesce. Cross ice Aho. Teravainen back to Pesce. Pesce trying to spin away from DeBrusk. Does. Now back out to the point where Shea has it. Shea hanging on to the puck. Back in. It's deflected by Grizzlick behind the net. But Aho's there to pick it up and get it right back to Shea. Shea. He risks one. Finds Teravainen. Teravainen. He's being marked there by DeBrusk. A great play by Aho to get the puck to Teravainen. Trying to center it back to Aho. Finds Shea. Now Pesce. Back to Teravainen. Cross ice. Shea. Down low for Aho. Back to Shea out in front. And that's deflected away. And Boston will clear. And the Canes will be able to make a change. And Boston has to stay hemmed in, as that's icing against the Boston Bruins.
Yeah, that's critical because Jake DeBrusk and company are tired. I thought DeBrusk was Boston's best player in the first period. He led the Bruins with three shots. This is the beauty of not being able to change the team that is guilty of icing. Let's see if fresh legs could be the difference.
For the Hurricanes, they will put Trocheck and Svechnikov up front here on this 4-on-4 with 53 seconds remaining. With four aside, Trocheck. He waved out, and Holla takes the draw against Svechnikov, and he wins it. But Trocheck trying to get the puck away from McAvoy. McAvoy sidesteps that, and the Bruins will clear. They need to make a change as DeBrusk puts one right on Freddie Anderson, who catches it. And now the Canes will try to catch the Bruins in a change. Boston completes it. Trocheck into the Bruins end. Banks that off the side of the net. Now D'Angelo. Ian Svechnikov. Try to keep it away from Riley, but Carlo will come up with it for the Bruins. 25 seconds left on 4-on-4 hockey.
Svechnikov is constantly working on things after practice. I think he's going to start working on faceoffs. And he's always been a winger, so he doesn't have any history in the dot, but you watch. He'll start working on it.
No doubt. And again, and hard work and skill meeting a player like Andrei Svechnikov. Sky's the limit. Now Taylor Hall. Number one overall pick of the Oilers in 2010. Wings it wide. Kept in at the point, though. Boston now tries to generate a shot in front. Anderson somehow gets across. It's still loose. Boston's second attempt. That's going to be knocked down by Pesci as he got a knee in front of it. And now Natchez will come away. The penalties are expired. It's 5-on-5. Carolina sends it in. Niederreiter trying to connect to Stahl. Rap chance. That goes out in front as nobody was home for Carolina. Now Marchand. We get it to Forbert. Boston into the Canes zone. Bruins trying to complete a change. Looking like a fire drill out there for the Bruins, but they kept it in. And Frederick Anderson hearing it from the crowd, the Freddie chants from the Caniacs as he again with another dazzling save. A Pasternak. Boston looking for some offense. Trying to step away from Stahl. Pasternak will just wing one. That hits Marchand out in front. Marchand shot deflected by Shea. And that'll go over the glass into the netting, stopping things with 16:22 here in the second.
Key play there from Shea because he was at the end of his shift. The Freddie show continues. Lateral movement. Attacking coil at the last second. Big time save. Oh, get that man a Danish. And at the other end of the rink, Jordan Stahl is sealed on the wraparound attempt. Pretty entertaining 4-on-4 hockey. The Hurricanes controlled things territorially. Freddie's had his mark on this. His regular season numbers as a Toronto Maple Leaf and an Anaheim Duck against Boston are very, very good, and he has been a difference maker so far in this game.
It's game 399 of his career tonight. His last three starts for the Hurricanes, he's only allowed one goal in those contests. And the great Dane indeed, Tripp. He has been outstanding here, winning his first five starts with the Hurricanes. First netminder to do that in franchise history. He's only the second in NHL history to win his first five starts with a new team. And Boston will win the draw. Forward throws it out in front, deflected! As Lazar was out in front in a big save made by Anderson. And that gives us a chance to get a look at the Liberty Mutual Insurance crease coverage, Tripp.
Look at these sparkling numbers. 7 hours later in Denmark right now. Ernst Anderson, his father was a goaltender, as a carpenter. His mom, Charlotte, if you're staying up late with us, hello. Boy, do they already love your son in Carolina.
Oh, absolutely. I'm already hearing the chants from the crowd for Frederick Anderson. And those numbers continue to dazzle, as he does as well. It's Coach Kiniemi. Tenacious. Back for Coach Kiniemi. They'll let it go all the way to the point. Where he's settled down by Ian Cole. Trocheck sealed off, but Kokaniemi throws one through the blue paint. Now Cole, his shot goes wide, bounces off the back of the net. Kokaniemi tries to get a stick to it. D'Angelo helps keep it in for Carolina. And he bounces off of the glass. It'll be loved down by DeBrusky. He bounces around. The Bruins will clear and get the puck forward to Curtis Lazar. He came across with Taylor Hall in the deal with the Buffalo Sabres last year. And the Sabres sent Hall to the Bruins. For Anders Bjork, a few draft picks. And the Canes looking for more offenses. Martinook, he's gotten a stick put into the midsection. And just throw it into the Boston zone and will pop out. But Martinook will retrieve and wait for his teammates to tag up. And Martinook finishing Hall along the boards. Slavin helps out. You get a good look at Jacob Slavin there on Nosek. Carolina will send a puck in the Bruins end skate race, and the Bruins will win it, icing against the Hurricanes. Faceoff coming back in the Canes end.
Well, we're in a spot that Carolina, with the same line on the ice, was having to stay on off of icing in the second period, where Lawrence, with his family here, I'm told, step on, and Martinook did the heavy lifting, and he scored a beautiful goal. Let's see if they can do it again. Similar situation.
We'll stick around. We'll hear from
Stevie Lawrence's parents coming up after the break with Abby LaBar. Boston able to keep it in as the Hurricanes trying to get a change. Stephon, he'll clear. They'll get a help from a tip from Mr. Lawrence.
If they're anything like his their son, they're going to be full of positive energy. You don't want to miss this interview, that's for sure.
Absolutely not. Now Marchand gets taken off the puck, and Niederreiter goes in after it, walks around Riley. And he takes a punch right to the mush. And no call. Yes, a call is coming up. As Niederreiter has been very good tonight with physical play, and he draws a penalty. Carolina will be going on the power play.
Nino has just played an extremely heavy game all year long. He's been rewarded to a degree statistically, but that doesn't begin to tell the story. Takes a look, checks to see what's in front of the net. Mikey Riley comes up high, gives him the face wash. Nino has had a heck of a year. He gets there first because he's moving his feet. He seems quicker this year.
The Carolina Hurricanes power play. It's a Powerball power play. Carolina 6-for-19 with a man advantage this year. That's fourth in the NHL. Bruins' penalty kill has been very good. They killed off 13 of 15. They're eighth in the league here in the early going. So we'll see if the fourth-ranked power play that's operating at a 31.6% clip can continue to go and extend to Canes' lead. It's 1-0 Carolina. As Riley's in the box and the Canes on the power play. Work from Svechnikov to Karavainen. Down low, Karavainen being hassled by a couple of Bruins. Forbert and Nosek are there. Krochek will set it out. Now it'll be D'Angelo looking for a lane, but it'll bounce it off of the shin pad of Charlie Coyle, and Carolina has to tag up. They do. And Karavainen to Krochek. Svechnikov leaves it for Aho to D'Angelo. D'Angelo trying to find Svechnikov. That pass off target in Boston will send it the length of the ice, and there's just a minute left in the power play.
Excellent penalty killing from the guy that got Boston's first goal last night, the Boston native Charlie Coyle.
Now Stahl allows Natchez to charge into the zone, and Carolina tries to set up with this power play unit. Bruins look for a clear, and they do as it gets past Pesce. And just 45 seconds left in the man advantage for Carolina. We'll get a look at Brett Pesce trying to set up the Carolina Hurricanes power play. He'll leave it back. With speed, it's Natchez. He'll get it forward to Stahl. Stahl flips it back just out of the reach of Natchez. Marchand looks to clear. He gets help from Bergeron, and we've seen these two do this for years, and now Bergeron wisely just shoots the puck on Freddie Anderson as he needs to go make a change, and the Bruins do with just 15 seconds left in the Canes power play.
Terrific penalty killing. Let's see if the Bruins get a lift.
Niederreiter will put one on that Swayman detects. Stahl behind the net. 5 seconds left on the man advantage. Pesce sends it across. Natchez hammers it, but fans on it. And now Stahl. As it was a one-timer there, Natchez gets it back. Tries to find Stahl. Penalty is over to Riley. Boston's back at full strength. Carolina 0-for-1 on the man advantage. Grizzlick with a heavy shove for Natchez. Allows him to clear the puck to Holla. Canes had one shot attempt on that man advantage. Mahala stopped the puck. No, get past him. And Carolina has Lawrence racing into the Bruins zone. Steps away from Studnicka. Coyle will get to it, but Stepan's there for Carolina. And Carolina Hurricanes crowd here in boisterous numbers on a Thursday night. Carolina versus Boston. A 1-0 Hurricanes lead. With 11:35 to go here in the second period. As this puck is deflected out of play, and that will stop things there. And we'll find out what the parents of Stephen Lawrence have to say about their son's game with the Canes up 1-0.
Parents, I have Karen and Mark here. This is the first time, guys, that they have been able to watch Stevie play in an NHL uniform because of the COVID restrictions last year. So, Mark, I want to start with you. This is where he plays every night. What are your thoughts on the environment and the fans here?
This place is amazing. I'll tell you what, I've been to Toronto many times, and there's more people than this, and it's quiet. This place is electric. I love this place.
All right, Karen. Well, you witness a lot of firsts when it comes to your son walking and talking, but you witness his first as far as the NHL goes virtually. What does this moment mean to you?
It was incredible. It's everything he's always dreamed of, and we're happy for him and proud of him. So exciting.
Mark, you said you couldn't sleep last night. You wanted to watch him make his first lap down in the corner on the glass. What was that moment like for you?
You know what? I've been there. I've done it 1,000 times, and this was the best of all. It's so amazing. This is such a great night. Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. You guys can feel the emotion down here from these two. Really a special night for the Lawrences.
Absolutely, and great for them to finally see their son play here in person in Carolina. And you can, even through the masks, see the smiles on the Lawrence family face, and maybe he's got another goal in him tonight. Had the game winner against the Toronto Maple Leafs on Monday. Now Carolina.
I might consider throwing a new line on the ice. LeBar in the middle between Lawrence and Lawrence. Good looking line.
I mean, you got to think there'd be a lot of time of possession there for the Carolina Hurricanes. And the puck will find its way to the blue line. I wonder what Stevie would say about that.
Well, now is he going from Steven to Stevie?
I think we
went from Lorenz to Lawrence.
After the whole name thing, he does not care what we call him. He's just happy to be here. As the shot by Coleman is detected by Anderson and right on. And speaking of Mr. Lawrence, how about this move, Tripp?
Well, this is a dream. Having to stay on the ice off of icing, so he had to be somewhat tired, but you'd never know it. Turning, battling, locating, puck on end. And he scores. First game against the Toronto Maple Leafs. That's a dream that you'll never be able to take away.
He won all 3 faceoffs that he took for the Canes. He was a +1. 7th round pick. His shot from the point is hammered on and handled by Anderson as Grizzlick off the draw. Trying to sneak one past the Canes netminder. Boston trying to keep some action in, but it's going to be Aho for Carolina. Waiting for some friends to catch up with him. Aho with it taken away by Hall. Bruins will try to clear. Again, the Canes so good at gapping up. Defensemen knowing when to pinch and creating problems for the Bruins trying to exit the zone. And they will. It's Pesci. They get in the way of Hall, but Anderson has to come out and play it. Good stick by Anderson, and now Svechnikov deflects it into the Boston zone. Swayman out to play it. Jacob Zboril. Zboril's making his first appearance in an NHL game this season for the Bruins. Zboril crossing the line. Bruins played last night. Lost 4-1 to Florida. After scoring the first goal, Florida had 4 in a row. Now Pasternak has it taken away by Niederreiter. And Staal. Staal goes into the corner. Takes a check from Riley. Niederreiter with a follow-up. Still loose puck. Niederreiter bats it away. Fighting for it. But Pasternak will get it to Marchand. And the Bruins will clear. Now Slavin. Great play to keep it away. And bat it up the boards. And Jesper Fast has a step. Fast circles. Throws it out in front. Chance by Niederreiter. And Slavin shuts the door.
I think that he tried intentionally, Fast, to put that off of Niederreiter's skate legally.
Well, for the Carolina Hurricanes, this line has been so good. And Jesper Fast tried to get a quick one. Using Nino Niederreiter, Carolina up 1-0.
And Vincent Trocheck, I was walking through the locker room Monday, and usually at the top of the shaft of a stick, it has the name Trocheck to signify it's your pattern, it's your curve. But instead of it saying Trocheck, it says Leo. Leo is Vincent's 3-year-old son. He's obsessed with hockey. He's on the ice occasionally. But more impressively, he rollerblades through the house, through the Trocheck abode on a daily basis. I think that's cool. Hello to the great young Leo Trocheck.
And the other name that you saw was Lennon, which is Vincent's daughter. So he pays homage to both of his kids there as the puck goes out of play. And Vincent Trocheck, really good family man. And like you say, he can put whatever name he puts his son's name on his hockey stick. That's pretty cool. And there's been a series of that with the Carolina Hurricanes through history. I know Cam Ward used to have fun written on his stick and his equipment.
His dad, Ken, told him he had to have fun, and he would put his kids' names on his equipment as well.
Well, I've told the story many times. Ken Ward, who I miss, I always look forward to seeing, and we'll see him in December when we go to Western Canada, the Edmonton area. He told Cam at a young age, the more fun you have, the better you play.
Coming up on Saturday, don't miss an ACC Conference doubleheader between Virginia Tech and Georgia Tech. And then Boston College takes on Syracuse. Coverage begins at noon Eastern on Bally Sports South. ACC football on Bally Sports is presented by your local Ford dealer.
Cam Moore just raised a ton of money at the Chicago Marathon in memory of his brother-in-law, who passed away due to cancer. And Cam had some issues with his knees halfway through the marathon in Chicago, and he dug in and got it done.
Would not expect anything less from Cam Ward, finding a way to get the job done. Many times in a Canes uniform. Now it's Carolina trying to extend their lead. Right now it's 1-0. 8 minutes, 30 seconds to go here in the second period. Carolina and Boston. Here on Bally Sports South, along with Trip Tracy, Abula Barr, Shane Willis, our fantastic Bally Sports South crew. I'm Mike Maniscalco. Thanks for spending your Thursday night with us. It's been a good one. It was shot by Holla from about 100 feet out, right on that Anderson makes the save. D'Angelo will hang on for a second as it's the longer changes here in the second period. Cole Kaniemi showing some dazzling hands. Sends it across. Step on shot right into Swayman, and he'll hang on.
Cole Kaniemi, I think, has gotten back to the form he had in Montreal. He's worked. He's had some fire in his belly, and then his skill can do the rest. Turning, locating the open man as centerman. Actually, it's a partial change because it's Stepan, not Vincent Trocheck. He made the critical play, distributing the puck on the entry on the only goal of the game.
Stepan will dig in against Stanika. Stepan wins the draw, but it's out of the zone, so Carolina has to regroup. 7:50 to go here in the second period. Hurricanes up 1-0. Thanks to Tony D'Angelo's first as a Hurricane. Now Anderson comes out of his net, playing it in the trapezoid on a slow roller. Boston trying to keep it in. Coleman slaps it along the boards. Canes will clear. Now it'll be a batted puck that Coleman will just pick up at his own end.
Boston's played a good road game. This is the best team that Carolina has seen, in my view, so far this young year.
Absolutely. And Boston, of course, has had some struggles on the road this year. They're 1-2 away from Massachusetts. As a shot from Riley from far out, detected by Frederick Anderson, and he'll catch that and hang on. Faceoff coming up in the game zone.
Oh, the calm, cool nature of Freddie Anderson. And when we interviewed him after he was named the first star against his former team when the Maple Leafs were in town, I am trying to figure out, and I'm going to talk to him about it, if his heart rate ever elevates above resting.
The calm, the cool, Freddie Anderson.
If it does, I don't think he'll tell us.
Oh, I'm going to get to the bottom of it.
If there is one person who can dig in and find that information, it is you, Trevor. It'll be Faceoff to the right of Anderson. The shot's deflected from the point by Forbort. Carolina trying to clear Svechnikov. Battling behind the net as McAvoy jumped up and created a chance, but nothing of it. Now Carolina, Svechnikov into the Bruins zone. Svechnikov works his way, sets it out in front, and that's deflected just wide. As Ethan Barrett jumped in from his defensive position, now Taylor Hall. He tries a pass, but intercepted by Teravainen. Now Aho taken down, and a call coming up, and the Canes will get their second opportunity on the power play tonight as Sebastian Aho draws the penalty, taken down by Nosek.
Prior to the penalty, Svechnikov just has another gear. I wish he would have taken that puck, Andre, to the front of the net, but he has another gear. Aho managing the puck. He draws that penalty because he knows he's in one of the two blue stripes. He's got to be hard on the puck. And draws the stick infraction from Noshin. Rod will start with his second power play unit. You want this to be a competition for ice time. Of course, the contestants on the first unit just finished a shift. So natural to start the stall unit.
And for us, teams the Carolina Hurricanes will be going on a Powerball power play. Boston will win the draw and will send it the length of the ice. Anderson will set it up for
for Brett Pesce. Nosek in the penalty box, four tripping Canes. 0 for 1 tonight on the power play with one shot on goal.
Trying to thread the needle, they'll score! Nino Niederreiter's pass deflected out in front. It beats Swayman, and the Canes up 2-0.
A power play entry as a group with speed. Kokaniemi comes in with his net drive, and also does Natchez. And the puck goes off a forward wearing 28 for Boston. Yes, you create your own break, but Pesce playing on the power play for the first time since he was a member of New Hampshire. A pass was zipped, and Nino passed this puck, trying to find Natchez with pace. It goes off the forward. Kokaniemi had his best game a week ago against Montreal. This is subtle, but he drives the front of the net. Forward has to go with him, and you get the bounce.
You mentioned that pace for Niederreiter. He had both Kokaniemi and Natchez driving the net. Now the Canes up 2-0 here with a big power play goal that will go to Nino Niederreiter. He is the even strength variety. Both his goals this year came 5-on-5. That's his first power play goal this year. He had 16 power play goals last year's Frederick Anderson. Keeps the puck away from Curtis Lazar. Lazar got the stick in there. The Canes will take exception to that as Vincent Trocheck doesn't want that to happen. And the Canes standing up for their netminder. And they've got the fans standing up with a 2-0 lead here in Raleigh.
First it was just like these distant roars in the dark.
Niederreiter uses Derek Forbert to give the Canes a big power play goal trip.
Yeah, Freddie Anderson. He's going to get his first point as a Hurricane. What more can you do, Freddie? Pesce to Niederreiter. And this puck clearly goes off of the toe and then the knee or just under the knee of Forbert as Kokaniemi goes to the front of the net, as does Natchez, who was the intended recipient, and Freddie Anderson. Why not? Add a point to your repertoire. If that was a 200-foot play, I know you get a bounce, but any power play coming up the ice has to come up as a group, has to come up with speed. And there can't be any wasting movement, puck movement. Freddie got it to Pesce. Pesce passed that puck with velocity to Nino, and Nino, he had some pretty crisp passing to the middle of the ice for the bounce.
10th career assist for Frederick Anderson. For the Canes, a 2-0 lead here. Under 6 minutes in the second period. It's Boston with a snapshot from Pasternak, and Anderson will detect that and hang on.
Old Freddie, the playmaker.
Yeah. Well, you know, it is close to Halloween. And he has been a nightmare for the opponents.
I'll tell you what, I've really enjoyed watching what a daily pro Freddie is, which is a nice about face, because as a kid, let me tell you, I was afraid to go to sleep at night because I thought Freddy Krueger might arrive.
I know.
That's a fact. I mean, he haunted.
You are not alone on that one, partner. Took me a while to make it all the way through those movies, and right now you got to think that Freddie Anderson is haunting the dreams of some forwards in the National Hockey League. And that is violent, but certainly keeping them up at night. And Bergeron and Niederreiter collide in the corner. Niederreiter will come out with it. We're going to get a penalty behind the play, and it looks like Jordan Staal is going to be going to the box as he took down Patrice Bergeron.
Yeah, captain on captain, center on center. Atypical for Jordan Staal. He gave Patrice a look like, are you sure? But the Boston Bruins power play with all of its weapons will have its first chance of the night. That's a penalty.
Carolina, 11, minor penalty, interference.
He was already between Bergeron and Niederreiter, which would be Jordan's argument. He would have actually had to get out of the way. And why would you get out of the way? I'm afforded a replay that officials aren't. I'm not sure about that one. Because Jordan, where was he going to go? The optics of it don't look good. So the fact that interference is called does not surprise me.
For the Bruins, it's their first attempt on the power play here tonight. The Canes have the fourth best penalty killing unit in the NHL, operating at a 90% clip. Killed off 18 of 20, and this is a big moment here late in the second period between these teams with the Canes up 2-0. Boston's power play going to work. Slavin will chop it to Aho, can't clear. Bergeron will handle it. Now Bergeron interferes with Aho behind the plate. No call as Aho had tried to set up a shorthanded opportunity.
Yeah, that's one where if you call one, you'd really have to call both. Several years ago now on Hartford Whalers, pre-Christmas, the first time we saw the jerseys, I bring that up because that was the first time that Aho and Teräväinen killed penalties together.
Now the Bruins, Pastrnak to Marchand into the Canes zone. Taylor Hall will work it to Bergeron. Back up to the point, it's McAvoy across from Marchand. Now Pastrnak, he's bothered by Shea, and then Natchez gets a stick to it. And the Canes have a 3-on-2 developing. Natchez, Boston, Shea. Natchez tries to find Shea a little bit too far. Now back the other way. Pastrnak with some speed. Great work by Pesci, who got in between the pass intended for Taylor Hall. And now Marty Natchez had a lane and will just whack this one all the way down the ice, and the Canes will put four new killers on the ice as the power play continues for the Bruins.
If you're not scoring, find ways to help the team in other capacities, and there Natchez, after Brady Shea got cut up the ice looking for something offensively, came back and allowed Pesci to seal.
And now Jordan Martinook is going to be going to the box. It appears a call behind the play. It looked like Martinook had gotten interfered with, but Carolina will be two men down for 20 seconds. We'll see what the call is.
If it's a cross-check.
Carolina goal number 48, 2 minutes for cross-checking.
You know, with the emphasis on cross-checking, it's a tribute to the players. We have not seen many cross-checking penalties. Martin comes into contact. So far, it's both. Again, it's both. And now you're giving a team that's down 2-0 a 5-on-3. Granted, it's abbreviated, but Rod's got a great argument. You have to call both there. If you're going to call Martin or call Coyle twice, they both got involved. Big faceoff coming. I just think you have to earn a 5-on-3. It's got to be clear cut, and that was not.
And the draw is won by Boston. McAvoy has it. He fumbles with the puck. Aho charges after him here as the Canes are trying to kill off the 20 seconds left in the stall penalty. Now Pastrnak tries to settle the puck down. Gets it up top for McAvoy. Now across from Marchand. Stall comes out of the box. Hall can't connect on the pass from Marchand, and it's a 5-on-4, and Jordan Stahl out of the box comes up with it, and he's interfered with Pastrnak. Playing on as Aho will get to the puck. Now Aho on one knee has it taken away by Taylor Hall, and now a call is going to be made as the Carolina Hurricanes fans get out of their seats and are making noise for the hardworking Hurricanes penalty killers.
This is where your captain, he hated being in the box. Whether he should have been there or not, that's very, very debatable. But he comes out with a purpose after Aho did a terrific job during the short 5-on-3. And you see the stick of Bergeron gets between the legs of Aho's, and then it stays there. And now we'll go back to our second 4-on-4 situation of the period. This penalty killing for the Hurricanes just continues to be a heck of a story, because you're losing very important killers this week. Just look at it. Pesci, Slavin against Toronto. Jordan Stahl, Timmy Gleason. Boy, I remember when you were playing with Joe Corvo during that great series that Scotty Walker eventually won on the road in Game 7. You were a player then. You're doing a super job so far as a coach, and specifically with the kill.
Well, the Bruins and Hurricanes will be 4-on-4 for a minute and 27 seconds. The Canes, by the way, the penalty killers trip that you were giving all of those accolades to and well deserved for Tim Gleason and company. It's a quick 2-for-2 on the kill here tonight. And now Trocheck using the stick like a wand right now to walk the puck into the Bruins zone. Bear. He'll launch one deflected wide. Slavin might have gotten a stick to that. Trocheck trying to keep it in, but DeBrusque will take it away, and Haller will have it. He'll just ease this into the Canes zone. Slavin bunts it down, and now Svechnikov has got a break. Svechnikov in on Sweden, fires it wide. Andrei Svechnikov was thinking upper corner.
Slavin's ability consistently, usually right around his own blue line, to bat pucks out of midair is remarkable.
35 seconds left of four-on-four hockey as Bear will deflect the puck in, but that's going to be blown dead here. And let's get a look at that chance from Andrei Svechnikov.
Yeah, it did. Again, it's a nice pass and transition from Ethan Bear. He does that well. I mean, there is a ton of flex here. He sees his location. It's late in the period. Puck comes off clean. I don't think he missed it by much. You see the flex and the power in that release from Andre.
I thought you were going to make a Get Smart reference. Missed it by that much.
Now I'm still trying to get smart.
Well, you're there.
Now, out in front, Taylor Hall can't handle the pass from Pastrnak as Aho with an outstanding back check. And in 10 seconds, Carolina will be going on the power play for the third time tonight. As the puck will be deflected in by Teravainen for no icing. The Carolina Hurricanes for 33 seconds are on the man advantage, so that means it's a power ball power play for the Canes. It's Pesci up front, right on, and Swayman with a glove save, robbing the Tarrytown, New York native of a power play goal.
Almost the second goal of the night and second of the year for the Carolina defense. Aho had made a big-time defensive play. Martinuk gets it to Pesci. He has time. And Swayman, Hockey East on Hockey East. Glove well in front of him. Swayman, this is the play from Aho. Late in the period, 2-0. You wonder why you have a winning culture when you have a buy-in on both sides of the puck, like we've seen so far this year, and right there.
The Canes have 25 seconds left of the power play to work with. Boston tries to clear, and they'll hammer it past Tony DeAngelo and take time off of the penalty to their captain, Patrice Bergeron. He's in the box for tripping Sebastian Aho. Not your normal power play unit for the Canes is Slavin and DeAngelo are out there. DeAngelo now cruising with some speed into the Bruins zone. Out of the box now is Bergeron. Canes have to be wary of that. Good play by Staal. Boston will just ease the puck in with 60 seconds remaining here in the second period. And 2-0 Carolina lead. Charlie Coyle ambling into the Canes zone. He sets it up. Shot right on as McAvoy steps into that. And that's deflected out of play.
Huge save. The sound that I heard from up here sounded completely like it hit the handle of Freddie Anderson's stick. Let's see. The sound. It's a particular sound. I don't think it caught the pipe. I think it caught the shaft of his stick. See how he attacked the puck? You attack the puck with your hands in front. You actually have more coverage on the shaft of your stick playing into the shooting funnel.
Anderson played that percentage. Played it right for the Carolina Hurricanes. 24th save of the night for Frederick Anderson, but it's Sebastian Aho keeping the puck in the Bruins end for the moment. The Canes forecheck, trying to keep it away from Marchand. Svechnikov with a shove for the Bruins alternate captain. 28 seconds to go here in the period. McAvoy paws down the puck at center ice, gets it to Pastrnak. He takes a shove. Anderson sticks the puck into the corner. Now Bergeron loses his edge. As it's 37-on-37, Svechnikov will get to it. 10 seconds remaining here in the second period. Boston trying one last chance, but it's going to be too far. And icing against the Bruins with 6.6 seconds remaining here in the second period.
Another fun period of hockey. And now a chance to put an exclamation point on it. Offensive zone faceoff. Aho's goal, the first goal of the week here on home ice against Toronto. It was off of an offensive zone set faceoff play.
Stepan will take the draw, but it'll be handled by Grizzlick with 2 seconds left here in the period. And 1 second, time expires, and the second period in the books. Tony DeAngelo with his first goal as a Carolina Hurricane. We'll join Abby Labar coming up on the PNC Bank second intermission report. We'll have After 40 with Abby and Shane, and your second period highlights coming your way. It feels like a playoff game here, and it's just game six of the season. Frederik Andersen has been locked in for all six starts for the Hurricanes, and he's a big reason why Carolina is up 2-0 after 40 minutes of play.
Two periods as we welcome you back into the PNC Bank Intermission Report. I am joined by Tony D'Angelo, who scored his first goal as a Carolina Hurricane. Tony, you thrive in these environments where there's energy and physicality. How have you enjoyed this game today?
Yeah, fast paced. Our fastest paced game of the year. Boston came out real hard in the first. They played real well in the first. I think we kind of took it to them there in the second. So just one more period, do the same thing, come out with a win.
Tell me about your goal and what you were thinking when that happened.
No, just trying to get the puck in the net. I didn't even see what happened. It took a bounce, maybe off Boston's stick. I know it changed direction. It was a good play by Troche. He beat the guy in the battle there. And then Brady made a nice pass over. So just trying to get it to the net.
All right, what's it going to take in the third period to hammer this one home?
Yeah, stay out of the box. We took a couple penalties there. It weren't great calls, but we took a couple penalties. And then just keep playing the same way we were, and I think we'll be fine.
Thanks, Tony.
Yep, thank you.
On the other side, Shane and I will break it all down for you after 40 minutes here on the PNC Bank Intermission Report.
Hockey is presented by PNC Bank, the official bank of the Carolina Hurricanes, and brought to you by UNC Rex Healthcare, official healthcare provider of the Hurricanes, and by Advance Auto Parts. Advance your auto.
It is an absolutely electric Thursday night here at PNC Arena. The Canes up 2-0 over the Boston Bruins, and the crowd gets rowdier as this one goes on, Shane. We have been able to feel that energy, that fight from both these teams on the ice here tonight, but we can't go without talking about the guy in net who keeps it calm, cool, and collected the whole time.
Well, it only took six games, Abby, for the Freddie chance to start from the Hurricanes faithful in this building. The Boston Bruins have come out with a ton of speed in this game and have created some chances, but each and every time they have, and if there has been a breakdown by the Carolina Hurricanes, Freddie Andersen has been the guy once again to slam the door shut and make sure his team holds them off the score sheet.
Well, we've seen a little bit of everything, especially in that period. There was a 5-on-3, a 4-on-4, power plays, PKs. This is going to take a full 60-minute effort, isn't it?
This is the closest thing to a playoff game we've seen so far this season. It is fast, it is furious, and it is physical. Right now, the Boston Bruins lead 37-25 in hits. The entire last game against the Toronto Maple Leafs, it was 19-16 for the Leafs. This is why this game is such a grind. Boston's going to push you to that limit. And the Carolina Hurricanes have answered here tonight and played a physical style game led by Jordan Staal's line. They have been outstanding all night long, creating chances using that physicality.
Well, when you say Boston is going to push the Canes to that limit, Nino Niederreiter said exactly that to me after the first period. He said, we have to try to frustrate them, especially that top line.
Well, the Boston Bruins are known for their physicality. They play with an edge. And if the Carolina Hurricanes can continue to take away their chances and frustrate them physically, you know the edge Boston is going to step over the line and continue to march to the penalty box. Right now, the Hurricanes have the edge in specialty teams. Another power play goal in the third period could end this one.
I like it. It's bold, Shane. You mentioned the hits. Let's take a look at the rest of the stats through 40 minutes here in PNC Arena. And there it is highlighted on that sheet, Shane, as you take a look at the rest of these. On the other side, we will have highlights. Stick with us on the PNC Bank Intermission Report.
Really good hockey tonight as the Hurricanes have a 2-0 lead over the Boston Bruins after two periods of play. And Tripp Tracy, what have you seen in the first two periods out of the Carolina Hurricanes? And most importantly, that second period that's gotten them this 2-0 lead.
I think Boston has played a good road game. There's no question. In the almost first six games, they have been the toughest opponent that Carolina has faced. Hurricanes have been more than up for the task. When you have a 1-0 lead with a team that has the weapons and is playing the type of game they are tonight, you have to have the urgency to extend the lead. And that's exactly what the power play goal did. Hey, listen, you can look and say you get a bounce off a four-board skate, but you earn that bounce with speed coming up the ice and with guys driving the front of the net. And Niederreiter could have easily, we'll see it in a second, held on to the puck. He was able to force it through the middle because Kokaniemi and Natchez both drove
the slot area with speed.
All right, well, let's get a look at those second period highlights for the Carolina Hurricanes. And Frederick Anderson, he's going to get a big assist on this, but so is Brett Pesce from that blue line spot.
Well, listen, I don't care if you're an excellent puck handling goaltender. It's not Freddie's thing. Oh, he's gotten more comfortable. Leave it, okay? Don't play it. Leave it. He leaves it for Pesce. And Nino, like I said, Nino could have easily decided to hold on to this puck. But he had two options. He had Kokonami driving the front of the net, which creates the seam even though it didn't get to Natchez. So that was a very alert power play entry. So far, in a very small snippet for me, the biggest improvement that Carolina has made against an excellent team like Boston in looking at the two playoff series that eliminated Carolina is the center ice position. So far tonight, Staal has outplayed Bergeron. Aho has been his dynamic, electrifying self. And you're not even talking about Trocheck and Stepan. The Boston centerman outplayed Carolina in both playoff experiences. Carolina now has 1-4. They're better at the center ice position.
Well, we just got that snippet from you, but now let's get a full take. Your Taco Bell take, Trip.
Well, I'm going to go from the bottom up because I just mentioned a big takeaway, not just for tonight. Carolina centers big step forward, and you can't take a breath against the big line for Boston.
Third period coming up. Canes have a 2-0 lead over the Bees.
Hurricanes up 2-0 over the Bruins, and again, a team effort from Carolina, and you need that when the Bruins come to town because their top line of Brad Marchand, Patrice Bergeron, and David Pastrnak have been Hurricanes killers in the past. When you look at Marchand with 23 points, and then you've got Patrice Bergeron with 32 points and David Pastrnak, new to the party, with 13. What have the Canes done to contain them so far tonight, Trip?
Jordan Staal up front has played along with Niederreiter and Foss. They haven't just played them toe-to-toe. They've spent probably the bigger percentage of shifts against the Bergeron line in the Boston zone. It's that simple. Slavin and Bear, for the most part, have been the two guys on the back end. But if you can't get Slavin with last change, you want Pesce. But it's been Jordan against Patrice, and so far, Jordan's had the night.
So when you say it's that simple, that's it. And that's what the Carolina Hurricanes have done tonight. But they've got 20 minutes here and a 2-0 lead to protect as the Bruins do come back out with Bergeron against the Staal line. Ethan Bear to the puck, but Bergeron will get to it. Pastrnak, sharp angle, and Anderson, no problem there. Let's find out what Abby Labar has in store for us. What's going on, Abby?
Well, Trip Tracy, I know you love talking about your neutral zone, so I asked Rod Brind'Amour how they were playing or which area were they playing the best in, and he said, actually, we've just been okay in every area. Wants to see them grind it out more in the offensive zone, and he confirmed this is one of the toughest games. No room out there, guys.
Absolutely not, Abby. Thanks. Good stuff. Hearing from the head coach, Rod Brind'Amour, and Trip, as you know, that he will give the credit when it's there, but you also know he is not one to shy away from what his team needs to improve on.
I did think of that all-important neutral zone. Carolina was much better in the second period. They're going to have to play 60 to finish the job.
Now they'll go for a line change as Nino Niederreiter deposits the puck in the Boston zone, and five new players out for Rod Brind'Amour. As we've got 55 seconds gone here in the third period. Boston with a shot right out in front. That hits a skate. He's trying to connect on the pass there with Stadnicka and missed it. And that gives Kokoniemi a chance to fly with Trocheck. Plays onside as Kokoniemi tries to bank one off the side of Swayman. Now a turnover. As Trocheck had it for a second but lost it. And back the other way is Taylor Hall and company. Hall trying to come up with a puck. Knocked down his own man, Brett Pesce. Bothered by Eric Halla. Pesce uses the glass to smartly get the puck back into the Boston zone. Natchez got a good look at him skating into your living room. Takes the puck away from Grizzly. But Halla comes down to help his defenseman. Brandon Carlo tries to fence it out. Instead, it goes back to Trocheck to the point. Cole shot, though. Catches Lazar, who got in front of that as Ian Cole tried to center one. Now Cole with his head up gets the puck to Natchez. Natchez taken down by McAvoy, and the Carolina Hurricanes will be going back on the power play.
McAvoy was right off the bench, and he was absolutely trying to label Natchez. Ends up being a leg-to-leg collision. McAvoy has just come on the ice. I don't see any ill intent here from Charlie McAvoy because he's trying to bury it. And then
the elusive, the agility of Natchez changed the point of impact. So there's nothing wrong with it, but as soon as you see a leg-to-leg collision and Natchez go down, you worry, but he seems to be okay.
As you see Natchez on the bench, Carolina Hurricanes have 2 minutes, and that means a Powerball power play coming up with McAvoy in the box. 2 minutes to start off and a minute 59 gone by here in the third period. A power play of consequence for a team that's already 1-for-3 with the man advantage so far tonight. As the draw pushes along the boards, Teravainen works it to D'Angelo. Svechnikov deflected out in front. Zaho was cruising the bumper position with Trocheck out front. Now D'Angelo, you get it to Teravainen, back to D'Angelo. Svechnikov tries to go to the seam. It's deflected, but Teravainen and company hold it in. Back to Svechnikov. His shot right into the glove of Swayman, and he'll hang on.
I watched Svechnikov in practice yesterday. I don't know if he scored a goal on a one-timer so far in his NHL career, but with Jeff Daniels, who does just a yeoman developmental job running the forwards, they were working on one-timers on the other side. You just want to improve upon it. Watch it. He'll end up scoring a one-timer sometime soon.
Let's see if Tripp's got the calls. The Canes win the draw. Trocheck to Svechnikov to D'Angelo. D'Angelo crossed. Teravainen, the shot's deflected right on. Swayman makes the save. Trocheck was out front. Now D'Angelo back to Teravainen. Minute 20 left in the power play. To D'Angelo. Svechnikov winds, shoots. That's absorbed into the body of Forbert. Boston will clear, and both special teams units will change up.
It's so easy to work on the things you're good at. And Svechnikov on his natural side, he's going to risk the puck. But if he's ever on the other side, he can put that practice to work, improving that one-timer.
As the puck rolls in on Swayman, Boston will be able to clear, and now the Canes will change up their forward group as well. As out comes Staal, Natchez, Kotkaniemi, Niederreiter, and Pesci. This unit has a power play goal here for the Canes tonight. They put them up 2-0. Natchez overskates the puck. Charlie Coyle will clear it for Boston. Bruins trying to take some time off of the penalty to McAvoy. Now it's under 30 seconds left in the power play for Carolina. And Riley will take more time off of the clock for the Bruins. Carlo will connect the pass to Marchand, but he'll overskate it. And that gives Niederreiter a chance to collect and possible time for one last rush for the Carolina Hurricanes. Pesci will drop it back for Kotkaniemi. 5 seconds left in the man advantage. Into the Bruins zone goes Carolina. But Carlo will get to the puck, and out of the box comes McAvoy. Canes now 1-for-4 with a man advantage here tonight, and Boston ices the puck. For the Carolina Hurricanes, some point streaks at stake, Tripp.
Yeah, and I mean, both of these players have been stars, plain and simple, throughout this young season. And at even strength, it's amazing, because when Svechnikov spends time on a different line than playing with Aho and Teravainen, as soon as he's plugged back with them, as was the case early against Toronto Monday, instant chemistry. It's pretty uncanny.
And both players have had a point in every game to start the season. They are the point leaders for the Canes. 9 points for Svechnikov to start the season. McAvoy out of the penalty box, centers one, and that's deflected away by the Canes and knocked out of trouble. Aho on the early season has 7 points, 4 goals and 3 assists. Let's see if they can keep that tally rolling. Right now they'll take the win as Lawrence into the Boston zone. He'll rip one right on, and Swayman with a right pad save. Lawrence, the 7th round draft pick for the Canes, has stepped into a big way. Now Taylor Hall generates an opportunity, and Anderson swallows that puck. And it's a chance for our Dell Technology in control. And it's a chance to look at Nino Niederreiter.
He's having a heck of a start to his year, period. We'll get to it momentarily. He's been an impact player playing on the left side where Fogel played. He has more offensive upside. But he's fitting on a checking line, but it's such a good line, they're going to create their offense.
Now Boston trying to create some here as Riley's shot doesn't get through. The opportunity by Coyle is deflected away. Now just dumped into the corner of the Hurricane zone where Shea will pick it up. His attempt to clear, knocked down by Coyle. Boyle from a sharp angle on Anderson. Rebound to Stagnika. He turns and fires. That hits Pesci up high. Carolina tries to chop it out. Aho can't. Coyle gets to it. Second chance to reload. That'll be deflected over the glass and out of play, stopping things with 14:46 left in the third period.
Here comes the Boston push. Now, this is not what you're thinking about, but ideally, you continue to press here smartly. When I was down for my bench interview with Jacob Slavin in the open of our show, the Chicago Blackhawks equipment was down by the Zamboni. They're already here. So if you can utilize all four lines, all six defensemen, that helps you for tomorrow night in your first back-to-back of the year.
Yep, the Canes in the second of this four-game homestand. By the way, the Boston Bruins played last night, lost 4-1 to Florida. It's their first back-to-back of the season. So maybe the Canes can take advantage here in the third period. But a power play coming up as taken down to the ice was Coleman. So the Bruins are going to get a power play when Carolina touches up on the puck. And now Boston will work the puck around. I wonder if it'd be better if they would just give it up right now, or with Swayman on the bench, try to get something going. As the Bruins will find Pasternak, the extra attacker. He skates into the zone. Pasternak gets it across for Carlo. They're working across. Stepping in is McAvoy. Backhand. That goes through the blue paint. And Bergeron was given a rough ride out front. The Canes will touch the puck in a power play coming up for the Bruins.
Yeah, that's why you hold on to it in the ensuing 5-on-4, because you end up creating a chance. 5-on-3, I personally think you should give away the puck. And Cole was guilty of the interference right at the offensive blue line. Left side of your screen. Yeah, he reaches out with, in particular, his right glove. And Cole, I mean, you have so many different guys that can kill penalties on the back end. So if a defenseman takes a penalty, you can overcome it.
The Bruins will be going on the man advantage for the third time tonight. Taylor Hall, the Marchand. Carolina will work the puck around. It'll be deflected back up to the point. Marchand to Bergeron out front. Anderson with the save. As Bergeron had a quick snapper on the one-timer for Marchand. Now in the slot, Marchand sends it across Bergeron. He misses the chance. Out in front, that was Taylor Hall who had the empty net and missed it. And now Boston's power play will give the puck up, and Teravainen will send it the length of the ice. Oh, Taylor Hall with a glorious opportunity, and then Boston will ice the puck to rub a little bit more salt in that wound.
A stratospheric pass by Brad Marchand. One of the great bumper men up high around the tops of the circles and the hash mark, and Patrice Bergeron over the last many years distributes the puck properly. Here he doesn't have, you see, bumper man gets the puck to the net. Boston at puck retrieval, and eventually Marchand gets a second effort from Bergeron, and Hall just didn't have the proper angle on the stick.
The Canes dodge the figurative bullet there. There's a minute 20 left in the penalty to Ian Cole, and now another giveaway of the puck, and Natchez is going to get a chance to get a step on Pasternak, but Pasternak eliminates Natchez behind the Bruins net. And away comes Taylor Hall. And now Carolina is going to be shorthanded by two men, and Sebastian Aho is going to be guilty for taking down Taylor Hall, who went down like he was in a hurricane wind there.
For me, this is a penalty. You know, it's just like Carolina creates the bounce on their power play goal, the bounce off of Forsberg in the second period. You come up the ice with speed, that's a penalty, in my opinion. And so now a significant 5-on-3. This is the chance, second effort from Bergeron. What a pass from Marchand, and Hall just misses. And now Cassidy will call his timeout. It looks like he's the one calling it, because this is really the game. In a lot of ways, he wants to use the same guys that were just on the ice and make sure that everybody is properly prepared for a two-man advantage.
Well, Carolina did kill off an abbreviated two-man advantage, but there was only 20 seconds in that one in the second period. This is going to be a little bit different. 61 seconds of a 5-on-3. And taking a look at what the Carolina Hurricanes have in store here to close out October,
They've already got one win on this four-game homestand as they beat the Leafs on Monday tonight. They've got this 2-0 lead over the Bruins. Our next broadcast will be tomorrow night on Bally Sports South against the Blackhawks. 7 o'clock face-off, 6:30 Hurricanes live. And then Sunday, Halloween, trick-or-treat, 1 o'clock. The Arizona Coyotes come into town to close out this four-game homestand for Carolina. Right now, it's Jordan Staal winning a big draw on a 5-on-3, but the Canes can't clear. Bergeron gets to it. He'll lose it. Now Staal will get the puck, and the Canes can rag some time off of the penalty to Ian Cole. As he's got 50 seconds left in his infraction. And that means 50 seconds of a 5-on-3 for the Bruins, with Carolina up 2-0 here in the third period. And Staal, with a monstrous hit, takes out Bergeron and McAvoy at the same time, and then Slavin will get to the puck. The crowd roars as the Canes take more time off of this 5-on-3 opportunity.
Yeah, Staal Bunyan, who won the initial important draw against Bergeron, and then the monster truck portion of the tour at the defensive blue line.
Now Boston able to get into the Canes zone, trying to set up the 5-on-3. Quick stick there by Teuvo Teravainen. The puck will be settled down at the point by Riley. Riley looks for a lane, settles it off, gets it back. Riley's shot deflected, and that's going to go over the glass. What a great stick by Teuvo Teravainen.
He leans on it to make sure he didn't break it. The leadership of this team, you start the 5-on-3, Staal, Slavin, and Pesci. And then stacking up, even though you're down two men at the defensive blue line, and Teravainen, that's a skilled play defensively. Rotates tight, turns, gets his stick in the lane. There's a lot of skill into what he just did.
There's 5 seconds left in the two-man advantage. Ian Cole will be sprung from the box. Sebastian Aho, though, will still be in the penalty box as he's got a minute and 5 seconds left in his tripping call. Jordan Staal wins the draw. Try to fence it forward is Pesci, but it's kept in. It's now 5-on-4 as out of the box comes Aho. Out of the box comes Cole, and a big save by Anderson. Well, that happens, and Staal is going to get to center ice and just gently slide this one in to take more time off of the penalty to Aho.
And that was key, because Cole, if he stays on, if he had to, you would have 3D on the ice.
Now Boston racing into the Kane zone. Traditional power play. Set up for Grizzly. His shot is deflected, and that'll go out of play as DeBrusque might have gotten too much of his stick blade on that one. 34 seconds left in the penalty to Aho.
Yeah, Boston's best two chances, both on the 5-on-4s that had a 5-on-3 in between. I don't think Carolina gave up a chance on the 5-on-3, but Hall missed a tap-in, and there DeBrusque in a similar spot, just a little bit higher off the crease, goes high.
Now the Canes will send this one the length of the ice. Ethan Bear controlling that, and just 20 seconds remain in the penalty to Sebastian Aho. This would be a huge kill for the Hurricanes as Coyle walks it into the Kane zone. His pass deflected off of Bear behind the net. Shea trying to get a stick to it, kept in. Coyle to Holla behind the Kane's net. Back up top, 4 seconds remaining in the power play. Grizzly shot right on. Anderson gets the glove to it. And out of the box comes Aho. The Canes have killed off the 5-on-3, but a dangerous attempt there as the puck goes loose. And somehow, Carolina survives the 5-on-3. 10:54 to go here in Raleigh. They're roaring in the stands, and it's a 2-0 Canes lead.
With the way he's played on the penalty kill here tonight, guys. Ethan Bear is one of 6 active Indigenous players in the NHL, and he is very proud of his Cree heritage, being from Saskatchewan, Canada, guys. He became the first NHL player to have his name written in Cree on his jersey when he played for Edmonton, guys. And this was a significant moment because it took many years for Cree to secure the right to use their own writing system. So when Ethan wore this jersey, he said he was honoring his heritage, and it was really important for all the Indigenous players before him and the current kids who dream of playing in the NHL, guys.
Good stuff, Abby. And I'll tell you what, he set a tone. Opening faceoff of the game. What, 2 seconds in, the big hit on Brad Marchand. His teammates, I'm sure, with this game meaning more than an ordinary one, they recognize that.
Right off of the bat, and Ethan Bear, Tony D'Angelo, Ian Cole have all integrated themselves on the blue line with this Carolina Hurricanes team. But you can see with Ethan Bear, just the heads-up plays that he'll make, where he's looking for those stretch passes from his teammates. And
the Canes right now have been benefiting from great work by the newcomers. And as Jordan Martinook told us, the OGs who have lived through two playoff losses to this Bruins team. And Carolina has not had much success against Boston in the last three, 4 years. They didn't play last year because of how the divisions were set up. And for Carolina, a measuring stick game right now. And the Canes have grown exponentially with their performance so far tonight as we're past the halfway mark of the third period. Now Cole works it up to Jesper Fast. Stahl will push it into the Bruins zone. You're looking at Niederreiter. And then Stahl finishes off McAvoy with a big hit, and a penalty will be coming up to the Canes captain on that hit on Charlie McAvoy by Jordan Stahl. As McAvoy was in a vulnerable position. So the Canes penalty killers are going to be called on to task one more time. Now DeBrusk trying to gain the Canes zone. The puck will be touched by Carolina. And with 9:25 left in the third period, the Carolina Hurricanes are going shorthanded. In the penalty box with 9:25 to go, trip for this infraction.
Well, McAvoy's head dips, but Jordan Stahl still could have avoided it. And he knew it. Watch. He's looking at it. He knew the minute that it happened that he'd like to have this one back. Minor penalty. He's mad at himself. And so Boston will get another power play. Boy, the kill again for the Hurricanes has been an extraordinary story.
They've killed off 2 5-on-3s in this game here. And right now they'll have to kill off their third penalty of the third period. Boston 0-for-4 with the man advantage here tonight. The feeling that with every passing power play opportunity, Boston will be gripping the stick a little bit tighter as Grzelcyk tries to work his way all the way in, and Freddie Anderson says, I'll clear it myself.
When you have an assist on the night, you feel pretty good about your puck handling ability to go up the middle there. Very smart.
Now Boston with a chance out in front as Marchand rips that just wide, and the puck will vacate the Kane zone. A minute 20 left in the penalty to Jordan Stahl. Boston trying to gain entry into the Hurricanes end. Yes, for Fast. Might have gotten a stick to it. Ian Cole leaves it for Fast, who chips it for Natchez. And what a smart play there by the Carolina Hurricanes penalty killers. A to B to C to out of the zone. Now just 60 seconds remain in the penalty to Jordan Stahl. Eric Haller chipping into the Kane zone. Bergeron goes after it, but Pesci's there for Carolina. Now Leafs puck finds Marchand. Work it along the boards for McAvoy. Center down now through the slot, and that will be deflected just wide. Bergeron tried to get a stick to it. Now Martinook takes down his man. Pasternak in the corner. No call. Boston already with 2 5-on-3s. Flirting with a third one here tonight. Now Shea trying to get to it. Too far for Hall. Now it's out top. Stephen Lawrence getting some time. Stephen Lawrence getting some time on the PK right now for Carolina as the shot out in front hits Holla, doesn't find its mark, and Carolina will clear with 15 seconds left on the penalty to Jordan Stahl.
Holla, during his brief time as a Hurricane, he can provide a good net front.
And now we'll get a penalty behind the play.
Too many men, I believe, for Boston.
We'll wait for the call because that's the whistle, and that should be the signal. Bruce Cassidy not happy with the bench management there. Here's the call.
Boston Billy bench minor for 2 minutes on the ice.
Let's take a look here. That's a no doubt about her.
It's about
you draw that with stellar penalty killing.
Yep.
I mean, you look at the two gargantuan kills when you were trailing and then got the lead for the first time against Toronto on Monday, and then at critical times with regards to momentum in this game, and you have a power play goal to boot.
Well, as you mentioned, can't be more too many men on the ice evident than that. It'll be 4-on-4 hockey for 6 seconds, and the Canes will be going back to the man advantage. Boston now 0-for-5 on the power play. Canes penalty killers outstanding. Just one shot on goal for Boston with their opportunity. Two shots total for all their power plays. Stahl comes out of the box, and that is a Powerball power play for the Carolina Hurricanes. Charlie Coyle is trying to set up one last offensive chance, but D'Angelo with the intercept. Stahl goes to the bench, and the Canes power play unit of Svechnikov, Aho, Tara Vinen, and Trocheck with D'Angelo quarterbacking out on the ice for Rod Brind'Amour. D'Angelo walks the line. Tara Vinen snapshot. That's deflected high, and that is the glass. Aho might have gotten a stick to it, and Boston will clear, and Anderson comes out of his cage to play.
Yeah, set play. Aho just missed. This first group has fallen off of a bit.
And now D'Angelo leaves it back hollow with the intercept, tries to get it across to Lazar. The Boston penalty killers tried to create a chance, but Lazar will lose the handle. And the Canes power play will try to get at it with 60 seconds remaining. And the penalty to the Bruins for their bench minor. Too many men on the ice being served by Taylor Hall. Now Trocheck crosses center ice into the Boston zone. Tara Vinen back to Trocheck to Aho. Behind the net, Aho bothered by McAvoy. O'Reilly gets a stick to it, trying to turn away from Svechnikov. Good work by Svechnikov. He forces the turnover. 35 seconds left in the Canes' power play, but then Svechnikov has his pass deflected, and Lazar will skate it away, trying to go one-on-one with Pesci. Pesci, good work to seal off the Boston penalty killer. But just 20 seconds left in the Canes' power play. Now a stuff chance as Lazar came up with a puck in traffic. But Carolina gets away with it with Kokkaniemi. His pass deflected. Canes have to get onside. They do. 8 seconds left in the power play. Niederreiter comes all the way across. Kokkaniemi can't keep it in. And the Bruins successfully kill off the Canes' power play. The puck still in action. Stahl deflecting the puck into the Bruins zone. Stahl takes a hit from two Bruins. He's still on his skates and gets the puck. Stahl up top. Quick shot by Barron. Swayman has to make the save. Slayman. Swayman with one of his biggest saves of the night. Niederreiter sends it for Bear. Anxious bouncing shot will deflect. Niederreiter trying to get a stick to it. Instead, it will come free for Pasternak. He'll just flip it on in as the Bruins were making a change, and he didn't have any teammates with him. Waiting for the change to complete. Now Bear, nifty play to take the puck away from Pasternak. 4 minutes and 45 seconds to go here in the third period. Puck would have made it for icing, but McAvoy picks it up as the Canes. Steve Lawrence is putting on the forecheck back into the Canes zone. Pasternak with it. Trying to sidestep around Stepan. Down low, Marchand. Back up top. Pasternak bothered by Martinuk. What a great play by Jordan Martinuk to stuff the puck out of the zone on David Pasternak.
Well, there just has not been a lot of room for the three magicians on the perfection line. Case in point, Martinuk there. Mostly it's been the Jordan Stahl line, but there Jordan Martinuk did it beautifully.
Now Carolina trying to keep Boston out of the zone. Hollow will deflect it in. Pesci tries to get a stick to it. Bothered there by Lazar, but Pesci will come away. We're under 4 minutes to go here in the third period. And we'll keep our eye on Jeremy Swayman, the Boston netminder, with Carolina up 2-0 here. Boston into the Canes zone. Nice little feed there by Ricardo, but can't be handled. Kept in by Zboril at the point. And DeBrusque chases Pesci. Pesci sidesteps him. And 3.5 to go here in Raleigh. Carolina up 2-0 over the Bruins. The Hurricanes 5-0 on this young season. Trying to get to 3-0 at home in game number 2 of a 4-game homestand.
Any time now, Cassidy down a couple of goals might think about upon offensive zone entry, Lipton Swayman.
Now Grizzlick behind his own net starts the exit. Now it's Stepnika into the Canes zone, pulls up on Slavin, tries to get it across for Taylor Hall, but behind Hall. Kokkaniemi tried to clear, instead it comes out and Stepnika puts it on, and Anderson has the answer. Now Grizzlick pinching in, keeps it in. His shot off of the post. Anderson reached behind him, but it deflects to the corner. Now Slavin puts a big bare arm on Stepnika, but the pass not out of zone. Stepnika in, and Anderson pokes it away. What alertness by Freddie Anderson. Ethan Bear is tripped up. The puck will come out of his zone. No call on Bear being sent to the ice. Boston right back into the Canes end. Slavin with a hand-eye coordination. Knocks down the DeBrusque shot. And away comes Brady Shea. And the crowd roaring again with their approval of Freddie Anderson.
Why wouldn't they? Right now, Frederick Anderson is the hottest goalie in the National Hockey League.
Now Carolina will keep the puck in, and that will keep Swayman in his net for now. Marchand will get to it. Tries to find Bergeron. Swayman leaves his net, but he has to go back as the Canes get a stick to it. Niederreiter now back into the Boston zone. Niederreiter and Faust. Jousting with Sporl. Now Boston will send it the length of the ice. Swayman saying, I'm getting off of the ice. Bring the extra attacker on. Empty net on the Boston end. The Hurricanes will get to the puck. Empty net from about 75 feet and a little bit too far for Brady Shea. And that'll be icing against the Carolina Hurricanes with 98 seconds to go here in the third period and a 2-0 Canes lead.
When he has a bunch of different tricks in his bag. And here Anderson, Stanika, it did look like he had his head down. But he lost control of the puck because of Slavin at the last second, so Freddie makes a spontaneous decision to attack with that mini jab. I love the decision because even if it doesn't work, he has other layers to make a save.
Well, Boston does not have their timeout. They used it with a 5-on-3. Now McAvoy from the top of the blue paint gets it down low for DeBrusque. Chances deflected away. Pasternak had an open net and couldn't connect. Now Grizzly sends it to Pasternak to Bergeron, and that might have hit the post. Anderson got a body to it. Now kept in, it's McAvoy. To the bumper, Bergeron shot doesn't get through. That hits the body of Brett Pesce. Bergeron now kicks the puck across. Pasternak can't get his shot off. Faust interferes. Niederreiter clears it to center ice. The Canes will make a change. 65 seconds remain here in Raleigh. Now McAvoy. The puck hits the lineman and bounces to Ian Cole. Canes catch a break there. Can they clear? No, McAvoy keeps it in just for the second. And then it's knocked out by Jacob Slavin. Under a minute to go here in Raleigh. Canes fans coming to their feet. Empty net for Boston. Aho gets to the puck. Sends it across a little too far for Svechnikov. Now Teravainen bodies the puck down, stays in the zone. Shot is fired wide. Anderson might have gotten a piece of it, but the puck all the way back into the Boston zone. It'll be picked up by Teravainen. Teravainen's got an empty net. The cross for Svechnikov. Bullseye! Another empty netter for Mr. Svechnikov. And the Hurricanes go up 3-0 with 25 seconds to go in the third.
There's that one-timer in that exact spot that Svechnikov was working on in practice after practice yesterday with assistant coach Jeff Daniels. Teuvo Teravainen takes a look up as he's going to the middle. He's already spotted Svechnikov. Svechnikov leans outside the dots, and I watched him for 10, 15 minutes work on one-timers from this exact spot yesterday. And the empty net specialist pounds home this game. Let's not kid ourselves. The Freddie Anderson show continues.
Sixth goal of the season for Andrei Svechnikov. And now there's one thing left with 10 seconds to go for the Carolina Hurricanes to cap off this game against the Bruins. 5 seconds left. Stepan has it. Throws it to the corner. And the Hurricanes, for the first time in franchise history, have started a season 6-0. And Freddie Anderson gets his first shutout as a member of the Carolina Hurricanes, a 33-save performance and another total team effort for the 6-0 Carolina Hurricanes.
And Derek Stepan goes and retrieves the puck. I'm sure that will be given to Freddie. D'Angelo gets his first as a Hurricane. Big, big win against a quality opponent. The finest opponent that Carolina has seen thus far. A history with Boston. And what an acclamation, a seamless one, Anderson has had to the Carolina Hurricanes.
And with that, not only do the Hurricanes improve to 6-0, their third win here at home, when they win at PNC Arena, that means we get a storm surge from this Carolina Hurricane squad. The Hurricanes salute their fans. And they should. They were loud again tonight. As everybody continues to chip in a power play goal from Nino Niederreiter. Tony D'Angelo's first as a Hurricane. Andrei Svechnikov just keeps scoring at will on empty nets. But Frederik Andersen, 33 saves and a shutout as the Canes exercise a mini demon of the Boston Bruins.
Well, the beautiful hug right here. I'm sure we'll hear from Freddie Andersen with Abby Labar on the bench momentarily.
The Carolina Hurricanes stay in the rarefied air of the only unbeaten teams left in the National Hockey League. It's 6-0. Just the Florida Panthers and St. Louis Blues remain as the last teams to get a smudge on their record. We'll see what happens as the Blues are trailing Colorado 3-1 in the second period, so three could be down to two by the end of the night. And speaking of three, we're going to be getting to the three stars of the game tonight. And as a matter of fact, let's get to it right now.
And the first star of the game from the Carolina Hurricanes with an assist. Oh, and a 33 save. Shutout! Number 31, Frederik Andersen.
A 33 save performance for Frederik Andersen. And the first star again for the Carolina Hurricanes. Let's get down to Abby Labar with Frederik Andersen.
Freddie, we've talked to you quite a bit lately, and for good reason. Your first shutout, you just made history tonight. I don't know if you look at the numbers, but you made history tonight as a goaltender. When you think about everything you went through in Toronto and now starting the way that you have this season, posting your first shutout, how does it feel?
Just really happy to be here competing on a really good team. I think we battled really, really hard today. Our penalty kill was amazing. I think that got us through the game, and I think it's huge. Another huge win for us.
When you talk about the way your team battled in front of you, fought for each other from start to finish, how does a performance like this today against a good opponent measure where you guys are at as a team and a culture?
Yeah, it shows we're on the right track. I think we want to keep going and keep building. I think every day we want to continue to get better, and we got another chance tomorrow, so.
How do you feed off of this PNC Arena crowd when you're staying so calm in net?
Oh, it's just amazing. I think I'm really just enjoying it, and it's pretty awesome.
Thanks, Freddie. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Guys.
Thank you, Abby. The Carolina Hurricanes tonight behind that performance of Frederik Andersen. 33 saves again. The Hurricanes and Bruins didn't feel like game six of the regular season. Felt like game 96. That means postseason hockey. A 3-0 win for the Canes coming up after the break. It's Hurricanes Live. You'll hear from Rod Brindamore. The players, there'll be highlights. We'll have stats, analysis, and a breakdown. And look ahead to the Canes' next game. That will be coming up tomorrow when they take on the Chicago Blackhawks. Up next, it's Hurricanes Live. And the Canes have a lot to like in a 3-0 win over the Bruins.